about that part. That's not the most important part. The most important part is that I was downstairs in this place. They were both upstairs. I looked, saw Grace's phone on the table, saw a text from her, from my dad and her dad, you know, coming in on her phone, and I looked at them, and it was like the craziest, like my heart started like pounding really, really fast. And now what I saw was like basically sexting, like him and her sexting. And I was like, holy shit, like what the fuck? Yeah. Like this is, like I knew stuff was going on, but like I mean, I don't think it's really invading privacy if I start seeing
fucking sex. Don't fucking care to me if you are invading privacy. That's pretty fucking,
yeah,
like,
no,
fucking,
I know, but that's yeah. their point, is that's that I invaded point. Her privacy, yeah, 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 and that's why it was bad. But I mean, it was like, bring me that big dick daddy. Like, and it wasn't a joke. And it was yeah. with a lot of eggplant emojis and like squirting water emojis. And it was just one of those things where it's like, what the fuck? And then I told my brother, and I like blew it up, and then they basically like humiliated me in front of everybody and called me like a pervert for even looking at her phone.
Wait, and they did as in just Grace and
Grace
Dad?
And Dad, yeah.
Okay.
They, I mean, I don't have any like physical evidence.
And I think it's disgusting, but she does stuff with my dad, and I know that she does stuff with my dad because they've had conversations with me where he's said that she orally rapes him.
Well, this is summed up.
Forget it. Forget it. I'm done.
Forget it!
Just messaging him to see...
Yeah, all she wants to do is just terrorize her mom. Like, look, I'll show you. This.
Okay, I got this stream on now.
I told her she trolled her mother the same way Grace trolled her mother.
This blowjob stuff, you know, they're free to do this thing. Not with me, but like, she's got this real problem. And I think they're welcome to send her pictures that she's going to freak out about. Man, take something and do that. Just to troll her to go, Jesus, because...
Dude, like, what? He's talking about blowjobs to his 14-year-old daughter.
Yeah, he's like, oh, we should continue the bit by now having my daughter go ahead and now pretend that she's getting molested.
It's all over. They said it's all over. It's stupid.
That's all I have. What a fucking asshole.
Answer your question about when things have been the best. Right now, they're the best.
Okay.
I've really, like, kind of discovered Grace's younger sister, Matt. She's wonderful. Wonderful young woman. She's just so funny. And finally, one of my kids has my same spirit of, like, thinking things are funny and, you know, doesn't freak out about everything. She just, I was yelling at her and she was just like,
but
so
Ben,
she's terrific.
So now you're
she's
saying
like,
you're,
it's like
you're
daddy's girl. This one over here is just this mirror of her mother. This just never stops.
Okay.
Like,
so Ben, you're okay.
Grace,
I'm ready
yeah,
to
yeah,
dump
true.
Her. She's
Grace
hit the wall. I'm ready for
Ben,
something new.
Ben,
six
I got
years.
A new daddy anyways.
He
lives in Mexico, so
Ben's
you
being
could
say I think teenage girls would really like
Ben,
me.
Ben, right now you're doing something. You realize people would be very upset and weirded out by what you just said, right?
Why do I care what anybody
right,
thinks?
My question is, okay, so there's two people. There's one person that's going to say, you're doing this to troll everyone. You're doing this to make people...
I'm telling you the sincere truth. Okay, what is wrong with saying that?
You're a smart guy. You have to realize that it sounds like you're implying that there's something weird with your other...
Only if only a weirdo would think that.
Me pulling her hair puts me in a vulnerable position. It doesn't hurt her. This fucking lying Brie is full of shit. It doesn't hurt a girl to have her hair pulled. That's fucking lies from these hellish women.
Fuck you, Ben. It literally does hurt.
But I do know what it's like to have hair pulled, and it's not a big deal, which makes me think all the other stuff is a bunch of fucking lies.
Okay. Well,
you fucking
okay,
love getting raped. You fucking
nobody
love.
Wait a minute. What? You like getting raped?
Yes. It's not that big of a deal for women to get raped. It's not that big of a deal.
What is at the core of marriage, you moron?
Giving?
All right. Fuck you. Fuck you. May you rot in hell for saying that. Fuck you!
We played a very long chess game, and I won. And my kids win. And I owe you nothing. And I wish you could finish the job and tell Grace that you hate her, you hate life, and you're a danger to them, her and them. And don't say, hey, let's do a fun stream about it. Do a stream. Do all the streams you want. I want nothing to do with you, ever. Until you make sense of your life. Stop playing this game that you're a nice person. You're a bad person. Bad people have to do something that you're not willing to do. That fucking guy should admit he killed his wife and his son. And that's it. I want to have fun in life. And I'm done. I'm done with the guns off our head. I got you to do it. Whether I manipulated you or whatever, I used YouTube and I did it. I won on behalf of my kids. And I have no responsibilities to make anything work in your life. I got the money. I got the kids. I got the house. You got a car that I can take back in 2 seconds.
Sometimes, you know, like puzzling. It has a, I guess you could call it a psychosexual dimension. Obviously, that's true.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a man. You're a beautiful young woman. That's true. Okay, there are dimensions of like family weirdness and all this stuff. Okay, sure.
Where she got pregnant before you guys even got married. I wouldn't.
Right, and I'm an idiot, and I don't get the like red flags at all, and I put my dick in crazy and keep putting it in there. So I'm like locked in with 6 kids.
Yep.
Until I'm like, wait a second, that's crazy I'm putting my dick into. And then I'm like, oh, shit. Well, I got to use the product of me putting my dick in crazy to help me get my dick out of crazy, which is pretty crazy, too. But I'm glad overall because I'm really happy about my life. I people say I'm a victim. I'm just saying that's what happened. I had to put my dick in crazy to get my dick out of crazy from the product of the dick in crazy, which itself became crazy. Mm-hmm. But I think I can finally have the relationship, which I actually wanted to have with your mother, but which I actually have found maybe with you, like whispering shit. It's like, it's annoying. So at a certain point she went outside and I was angry. And one of the ways in which, like, you know, men show anger towards women is by having them sort of humiliate themselves. So I did have her sort of humiliate herself for me outside on a FaceTime call. So she had this sort of like, you know, this has become in her mind sort of half of a, like a psychosexual sort of like, you know, serial killer situation, right? There's a certain part of them that wants to be dominated. They'd like it when it gets a little hot.
This is your daughter.
Right.
I understand that. Yeah. I understand it's my daughter. Okay.
And how does she humiliate herself?
She, you know, kind of played out some of those things. Nothing crazy, nothing that I wouldn't
like what?
See in the course of, I don't remember exactly what, but like, you know, she took some of her clothes off outside in a kind of scary situation. That's it. And I was like, okay, that's fine.
Disrespectful.
All right, let's go through this. Okay. Let's leave aside whether anything or not happened. Let's just say everything happened, right? So here is what it is. The old bag gets old. I get the 15-year-old, hot, whatever you want to say, 7, 8, for me, 10, chick, to suck my dick happily, get rid of the old bag. She gets mad, takes the kids on her side.
It opened twice. Right? Shut up.
As like trolls herself into taking care of my kids. So me and my hot daughter can fuck with impunity, because it's the state of Rhode Island, go on YouTube. I can do whatever I want, and I'm the Mac Daddy. Isn't that the problem with you faggots? You resent it.
How am I not the ultimate baller? An old man, I don't have to work out. I don't need money.
Base dad.
I get pussy whenever I want it. And I also convince this piece of ass that it's her fault. And she's not doing a good enough job. And that's not what your guys' problem is.
Okay.
Daddy issues.
This worked out so well.
And this nigga goes, yeah, he fucks her, then he beats her. Yeah, that's the fantasy of being a man. I fuck her, I beat her, and she brings me spaghetti. And she's sorry for all of it. Yeah. Yeah, men can do that. I don't. But I don't fucking care. If you want to fantasize about that, I get why you're mad.
If that's the fantasy,
dad pulls all the pussy in the house. And
if that's the fantasy, he wins. If that's the allegation, he wins. If it's not
and
true,
you
then
know
he
all your sisters and all your whatever, all the Gen Z girls go, ooh, gross, but they'd like to take, yeah, they'd like to sniff around just enough to get raped, beaten, and turned into my sex slaves too. Because you're not very fucking interesting, Lalo.
Hey, what's up?
Okay. All right, let's do it the other way now. Let's do it about Grace. Let's say whatever. Who cares whether it's true or not? How doesn't it work for her? She fucked her fucking loser mother over, got out of a situation where she had to be this sort of fake mom and prop her fucking loser mother up. Gets to sit on her dad's dick. He's a lot of fun. He gave her all the money, right? And every woman is resentful of her because she's got the real man. But all the young Zoomers are hoping they could get a piece of it because daddy's worked it in. So, and everyone knows that the hottest chick is one whose mother has driven her crazy and whose dad has been great to her and showed her what it is, how exciting it can be to be with a real man, right? Every guy my age wants to fuck Grace. Every woman my age wants to kill Grace. Every guy your age wants to fuck Grace, but no, she won't give him the time of day. Because daddy dick is the best dick, right?
Hey guys, welcome to All or Nothing Analysis. Welcome to All or Nothing Analysis. This is our second stream. We've got my wife, Amelia, here. It's Halloween. We're going to be doing a multi-hour stream that we've prepared in relation to the novel, the French novel, Diary of a Country Priest from 1936. This might seem boring to some people. There's going to be some reading, you guys. We're going to have to read some stuff, but we're trying to kind of frame Ben and Grace and their relationship through some points from this Catholic novel, Diary of a Country Priest. Also, shout out to Shamu. We used clips from the intro we did, of stuff he found, and beyond. We've taken stuff, we used clips from Lalo Stream. There's all kinds of people in the community. So, you know, just a heads up, we appreciate those people for, I mean, we didn't ask them, but they're going to see their clips used, and we appreciate us hopefully letting them use it. So for now, I'm going to ask Amelia, I'm going to undo her head box, and then we're going to begin the stream.
Hello. So, in the Diary of a Country Priest, the priest is really sick. He has stomach cancer. And so, he's kind of throughout the whole book losing his mind, more or less. And, you know, he's keeping a diary the whole time. So, he's filling it with all of his experiences.
Okay, so before we get started, I wanted to ask. Okay, so this is about a priest in a small French village keeping his diary. This book, in a way, kind of is a precursor that influenced, especially the film by Bresson, Paul Schrader, to write Taxi Driver. I guess also Pickpocket. But I guess we're going to read some of these pages. Luckily, I have copy to show everyone so they can read along and connect some of the pieces of Ben and Grace through this stuff. Might be boring to people, might be strange, but I think we wanted to use the language of Catholicism that we relate to with Ben and Grace. So where are we going to begin?
We're beginning here with him just writing down in his diary his sort of exhaustion, and it's sort of his own confession in his own diary. And okay. Here he's talking about how he's quite literally losing his ability to think, to do certain things, because he has terminal cancer, and yet he hasn't lost his faith. So he says, "No, I have not lost my faith. The cruelty of this test, its devastation, like a thunderbolt so inexplicable, may have shattered my reason and my nerves, may have withered suddenly within me the joy of prayer, perhaps forever, who can tell, may have filled me to the very brim with a dark, more terrible resignation than the worst convulsions of despair in its cataclysmic fall. But my faith is still whole, for I can feel it. I cannot reach it now. I can find it neither in my poor mind, unable to link two ideas correctly, working only on half delirious images, nor in my sensibility, nor yet in my conscience. Sometimes I feel that my faith has withdrawn and still persists where certainly I should never have thought of seeking it, in my flesh, my wretched flesh, in my flesh and blood, my perishable flesh, which yet was baptized. Let me try to put it as plainly, as innocently as possible. I have not lost faith because God has graciously kept me from impurity. No doubt that most philosophers would smile at such a relation of thoughts. Obviously, the very worst disorders could never so confuse a thinking man as to make him, for instance, doubt the validity of certain axioms in geometry, but with one exception, madness." So he talks about how God has kept him from impurity. And I think what he means by impurity is sin or a madness. I would define it as a type of dementia that degenerates the faculty capable of recognizing truth and love, or discerning them from untruth and cruelty. Sin is most definitely a sickness, but not of the body mind, but rather of the sanity.
So I think the next part is the most important part. So
he basically says that even if like a really intellectual man, like a mathematician, had terminal cancer, it would not confuse him to doubt or question the validity of certain things that he's established already as self-evidently true. But there's one exception, madness.
Okay, you want to start from there?
Yeah. After all, what do we know of madness? What do we really know of lust? What do we know of their hidden connections? Lust is a mysterious wound in the side of humanity, or rather at the very source of its life. To confound this lust in man with that desire which unites the sexes is like confusing a tumor with the very organ which it devours, a tumor whose very deformity horribly reproduces the shape.
Yeah, do you want to keep going?
Yeah. The world, helped by all the glamour of art, takes immense pains to hide away this shameful sore. It is as though, with each new generation, men feared a revolt of human dignity, a desperate revolt, the sheer refusal of still unsullied human beings. With what strange solitude humanity keeps watch over its children, to soften and advance with enchanting images this degradation of first experience, an almost unavoidable mockery. And when, despite all this, the half-conscious plaint of flouted young human dignity outraged by devils is heard again, how quickly it can be smothered in laughter. What cunning mixture of sentiment, pity, tenderness, irony surrounds adolescence. What knowing watchfulness. Young birds on their first flight are hardly so hovered around. And if the revulsion is too intense, if the precious child over whom angels still guard shudders with invincible disgust, what cajoling hands will offer him the basin of gold, chiseled by artists, jeweled by poets, while soft as the vast murmur of leaves and the splash of streams, the low-pitched orchestra of the world drowns the sound of his vomiting.
Wait, so let's talk about that part. Mm-hmm. So we understand some of this stuff might go over people's heads. We promise we're going to connect this with clips.
Mm-hmm.
But I think we were talking about this section last night.
Mm-hmm.
The idea that like a precious, the section, and if the revulsion is too intense, if the precious child over whom angels still stand guard shudders with invisible disgust, what do you think that means? What cajoling hands?
Well, they're talking about a basin of gold. They're talking about a bowl. Like what hands are going to offer this angel, which watches over this children. Precious child's innocence? Who will offer him this bowl to vomit in, basically, is what, out of disgust for the loss of their... Right. The loss of innocence, yes. Yeah.
Okay. And I promise this last part is, I think, where it means the most.
Yeah. But with me, the world was not so tender. At 12, a little pauper knows a good deal. What use would it have been only to know? I had seen. Lust must be seen, not understood. I had seen those hard, avid faces, suddenly fixed in indescribable smiles. God, how is it we fail to realize that the mask of pleasure, stripped of all hypocrisy, is that of anguish? In my dreams, even now, I can still see their hungry faces. One night in 10, I dream of them still, such sad faces. As I squatted down behind the bar, for I never stayed long in the dark outhouse where my aunt thought I was doing my homework, those faces surged above my head, and the dim light of a wretched lamp swayed by its copper chain, forever jostled by some drunkard, set their shadows dancing over the ceiling. Little as I was, I could always distinguish one kind of drunkenness from another, from the other, the only kind which really scared me. The young servant girl, a wretched cripple girl with an ashen face, had only to come into the bar, and those besotted eyes stared suddenly with such poignant fixity that even now I can't think calmly of it. Oh, of course, a child's imagination, the extraordinary vividness of such memories, the terrors they still awaken after so many years is sufficient in itself to render them suspect, no doubt. But let worldlings see for themselves.
Okay, so I think this is really important. Before we get into it, Dark Juice wants to know if we're Catholic. I was baptized Catholic, went to Catholic schools most of my life. Amelia, what were you baptized as?
I was baptized in a Methodist.
Right. I think for me, I mean, we could have an entire stream about our religious beliefs, but I would say this book right here means a great deal to us, and I would definitely identify as someone who accepts Jesus Christ into their heart and believes in Christian kindness and love and expressing those beliefs. But let's get into this. So the lust that the priest describes seeing as a young boy disturbs him and he couldn't unsee it.
Yeah. Again, he is going back to that whole thing. You know, he's describing this lust that is no different than madness in his eyes, and it is that madness that allows one to treat others in these heinous ways. So he can't understand it, even though he's seen it. It's kind of like this really interesting thing he's saying, like, I can't see faith. I've mm-hmm. never imagined faith, but I know that my faith is intact. Mm-hmm. And I understand that. But he's saying basically he can't understand something that he's seen and imagined. And I think it's interesting. It's caused him so much of this kind of terror that he still has these nightmares about it. It's something that really deeply disturbed him. And he's describing how, you know, lust can't be understood. Lust is right. a madness. It's a sort of right. abstraction. And he
can't. So he's saying because there's no way to understand madness through an intellectual effort or psychoanalysis, you have to see it. So also mm-hmm. we wanted to say, Billy gave a good point, and we forgot to add this. We know that Ben is aware of this novel, and I don't know if you've seen the film and has read the book, which we were interested in because it's a book that we had been reading over and over for years.
But it's one of my favorites.
Right. It's one of my favorites too, the film and the book. And I think, so here's our first kind of connection that we'll, I think all of us, we're all interested in what's happening with Ben, his actions and reactions, and that maybe there isn't a way to psychoanalyze him perfectly because you just have to kind of see the madness inherent in him in a kind of deeper spiritual way.
That it's wrong. There's a that faith that you're sure of. You don't need to understand it, like why or how this is happening or why it's possible for him to do those things. But it's just simply the fact that it is wrong. You know it in your heart when you see it, that right. it's unloving, that it's cruel. It's not just this natural thing that it can't be confounded. Lust can't be confounded to that natural desire which unites the sexes together. That's what he's saying. In fact, it's rather a tumor or a deformity which completely reproduces that, or like reforms itself. Yeah. Right.
Okay. Do you want to go to the next part? We have two more readings sure. and then we have clips yeah. to look at, guys. Don't worry. It's not going to be all readings.
So he said, but let worldlings see for themselves. I don't think we can ever learn much from ultra-sensitive, shifty faces skilled in disguise that hide themselves in lust as beasts hide to die. And thousands of human beings all agree live disordered lives, prolonged to the very threshold of old age, sometimes even farther, the curiosity of their never-sated adolescence. What can we learn from such shallow creatures? Perhaps they are playthings of demons, but not their prey. It seems that God, in the mystery of his own purpose, has not permitted them seriously to pledge their souls. Most probably they are children who failed to grow up, grubby, yet not vicious urchins, victims of such wretched heredity, displaying its mere harmless caricature so that providence allows them still to profit by certain immunities of childhood.
Okay. Well, that sounds like Ben a little bit, right?
Yeah, for sure. Again, the message is saying there's nothing for us to learn from those who are driven by madness. There's no way to understand, since this all comes back to that question, what do we really know or understand about lust? We cannot understand something that comes from abstraction and madness. Going back to that quote that I added at the beginning, Oscar Wilde wrote something like, ordinary cruelty is just plain stupidity. So how could someone understand cruelty through intelligence?
Okay, yeah.
So, and besides, it says, what are we to conclude? Because there are inoffensive maniacs, do no dangerous lunatics exist? Let moralists define, psychoanalysts analyze and classify, poets sing their songs, painters play with their colors like a cat playing with its tail, and mountebanks make a game of it all. What does it matter? Madness, I say again, is no better understood than lust, and society protects itself against both without really admitting them, with the same sly fear, the same secret shame, and using about the same methods. But if lust and madness are really one,
Okay, so basically they're saying there's no way to understand evil, lust, or badness. I know we're kind of reinforcing this point.
Yes. Yeah, we're not silly enough to believe that any analysis that we make will help any of you watching to understand the why or how of Ben's proud cruelty and lust. There are really no conclusions that we expect to reach other than the strength of our own faith, meaning that we know what we see when we see it. We know it's cruel when we see it. So this isn't love. Like, it's just very clear, you know, it's not loving actions from a person.
Okay, so let's begin with clips. Thanks for hanging in there, guys, through the book. Okay, there's more stuff later. All right, so we're going to add this to the stage. Chapter 1, Lust and Madness.
Story, when Grace was sunbathing with her friends when she was a teenager, and that you were looked out the window and masturbated.
All right, now
I started to. That's true. But anyways, they were sunbathing in the backyard where we were staying on the second floor. And I had a moment of, I would say, immaturity where, you know, there were blinds there and I put the blinds down, turned the lights off and did, you know, kind of an immature thing, which is to, you know, look at. You know, I didn't ask her to come over there. I didn't anyway. Okay, so a guy gets a little, I don't know, backed up, gets a little like wound up, wants to look. Like, I never looked at porn, but like, okay, you get it, right? So I was tempted. I looked at it a little bit. I looked at her a little bit, you know, started to whatever, and then it stopped. And then later on told her mother jokingly to kind of say like, yeah, I get it. It was stupid, right? I was stupid. I think they have a massive problem with a man my age. So I was a little younger. I was in my 40s then. And I saw an 18-year-old girl and I had a sexual response, which I responded to like a slightly immature way, but not in a creepy way. She never, to this day, I don't think knows about it.
Again, I want to add some context. Shamu was interviewing Ben on Ethan Rouse's stream and is mentioning a story that Ben had talked about in the past. Where Grace and a friend in high school, he claims they're both 18, were sunbathing on the back porch, and Ben watched them sunbathe and he masturbated. This is him admitting it. These are his own words.
And you know, I think that's perfectly normal. If an 18, I didn't know she was coming over. I didn't prep for it. It was just kind of spur of the moment thing, and it was kind of hot. Okay. So
how did this story come out in the first place?
I tell these stories because I want young men to not be so wound up, and men my age also to not be so wound up.
I mean, many of these are stories you told yourself. Do you regret telling some of these stories?
I don't. Okay. No, I don't.
Rachel, we're in.
Okay. So, do you want to read this next part, or should I? You got to unmute.
Let's go. We neither care nor feel the need to superimpose labels onto what we've seen. By classifying or labeling Ben, Grace, Courtney, or the family, we make it a sick and useless game for them to play with each other and with us as well. We recognize what is humorless, stupid, cruel, and unloving when we see it. That's the thing. You don't need someone to tell you what's loving or unloving. You know it when you see it. That's why we say it's self-explanatory or self-evident.
We especially do not expect for those who are mad themselves to ever make the choice of opening their eyes to the ignorance at the source of all evil. It is very easy to never recognize if you've never seen it. If you have never been willing to look at the consequences yourself, perhaps some find themselves in fear of finding that same thought. That same belief that led people like Ben to do sorts of things we've seen him do. This is our attempt to show this lust and madness, as there is no way of understanding it through the use of moralizing, psychoanalyzing, classifying, or even using the author of this book to make a creative portrait of this kind of thing. Like the author of Diary of a Country Priest is saying, you cannot understand lust or madness, you have to see it.
Yes. So
we're going back to the book?
Yeah, it's just the last little bit.
Okay.
We priests are sneered at and always shall be. The accusation is such an easy one, as deeply envious, hypocritical haters of virility. Yet whosoever has experienced sin with its parasitic growth must know that lust is forever threatening to stifle virility as well as intelligence. Impotent to create, it can only contaminate in the germ the frail promise of humanity. It is probably at the very source, the primal cause of all human blemishes. And when amid the windings of this huge jungle whose paths are unknown, we encounter lust just as she is, as she emerged forth from the hands of the master of prodigies, the cry from our hearts is not only terror, but imprecation. You alone have set death upon the world. So just going back to what he said right there at the beginning, we priests are sneered at and always shall be as being deeply envious, hypocritical haters of virility. This caught my eye.
Right. The word virility.
Yes.
That Ben uses a lot.
He does. Masculinity, virility. They're interchangeable. It's the same thing. So we've heard him say that a lot. To people who warn or object against his lust of children, his daughters, or like any girl on right. the internet. And so I really think that this is like kind of like what he believes is everybody's real problem with him.
Right. And we're not trying to say we're priests or anything like that, but it's just interesting that for people that critique Ben, that specifically people like me, he'll say that I just hate his virility. I hate his masculinity. I have a motherly vibe. And that I'm just a sneering mom. I think it's kind of interesting.
Mm-hmm. So you accidentally missed the clip of Ben and Grace on Hormaxer, but we can go back to it.
Let me play it quickly.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Sure. No worries. That'll bring him over here, and then we keep...
The context, we got to give context. For people that don't know, I bet everyone here probably knows what's going on, but this is a clip of Ben and Grace on Hormaxer, there's some, how would you describe what happens?
Well, she's being pushed to, in my opinion, just humiliate herself as a way to kind of teach her how to be feminine. And that's like just his own way of doing that, of pushing Grace. I mean, he's even said like, this is what, like anybody should be grateful. Like any girl would be grateful for their father doing this, but I think it's just purely humiliation. That's just my opinion. Yeah.
Right.
I'm over here.
I have never seen Grace as one piece of really feminine lingerie, garters, and everything.
All right. Uncle Max,
afraid of her own sexuality, even wearing sexual clothing.
All right, Uncle Max, can we pop her cherry tonight? Can we just pop her cherry?
I would love to.
I'll be right back.
Okay. Is a dedicated group of fans.
Grace, I see your tits. They look nice. Like the fondle you.
You're welcome.
At least you look feminine. Thank God. At least you look feminine.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Yeah. Okay. But now she's acting like I have deflowered her on the internet.
No, this is.
By the way, notice Ben. He says this.
You're muted. Oops. Okay. So Ben, I guess, is just here. He's just kind of like, he wants to be there for whatever this is. I'm not sure why. You cool?
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Sorry, my cat unplugged the USB mic, you guys.
Oh no.
But I plugged it back in, so isn't that cute, kind of?
Sort of.
Okay. Sorry, but the point I just wanted to say, like, Ben even knows Grace feels uncomfortable, and then he, instead of saying, "Oh man, I'm making my daughter feel uncomfortable," he pushes it on her. You're making me feel like I'm doing something wrong to you.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
isn't a big deal. So, are you gonna bring the game to keep me on the stream, or is it just gonna be?
What do you need me to Grace to kiss your ass on stream? You'll sit there with your tits hanging out. or whatever you're in, like a boost.
Well, let's, well, Grace, let's see the whole, let's see the whole thing. What do we got?
Well, I don't know. He doesn't know how to run his own stream.
No, you're, you know, the rest of your outfit there. What is it? How, I mean,
oh no, it's just the shirt. It's corset.
Well, can we see it? Or
let's see, because those fat book mommies are going to get very jealous, you know, Grace. They're so very jealous too. That's those women are the worst type of jealous in the world.
Oh, and you're wearing sweatpants underneath it?
Yeah.
Oh, for God's sakes, Grace. Can you put on garters? Yeah.
One step at a time.
Grace, are you on the team here or what?
I'm on the team. We're going to be stream sniping.
We're pearl clutching here, but we tried to kind of cover up Grace so we weren't just
Why don't you send some of these guys? Call them out by name, Bash.
Well, why don't you go on there, Grace?
It's his Coomer army. It's his Coomer army.
Hey, Grace, why don't you go on there?
You're Joan of Arc, right?
And your little tits sticky, little perky.
Keep in mind, for everyone also and in context, the idea was that Grace was going to, like, I guess, get all the other people from this other stream to come on. So she was like the bait. That was the idea.
Tits sticking out. And go tell them to bring them over here and use some bait then. What do you think? Yeah. I'm the bait to bring them over?
Yeah.
Go say, hey, if you want a real woman over here, come on over here. How about that? Why don't you lose your little ass, Grace, and use your little sexual appeal that you claim to have?
No, that's what I'm talking about.
All right.
Fucking princess, get lost. Go shake your ass out on the streets of Vegas of the internet.
That's right. I put her back on the highway.
Streets of Vegas of the internet. I'm sorry, I have to like just say that's an insane line.
Yeah,
Ferrari. It's like an absurd line that
I'd sell Grace's ass on Boulder Highway.
Yeah, right, get out there on Boulder Highway.
She's not even she hasn't even worked up to the strip yet.
Now call her mother and get her on here and get her to go, oh Grace, you've got to stop this.
Oh, shut up, Courtney. shut up, Courtney, you dis-eugenic subhuman woman. Rotter. Go over there with him and start sniffing Grace's panties. I'd violate you, Grace. I mean, I'm open about it. I would fucking tie you.
Him.
Yeah.
I'm just sniffing him.
I would tie you up, violate you, demolish you, and every
Ben just listening to this. I think I talked the last stream we were doing. I mentioned this to Ben, and what was he saying? He was just trying to like get Grace to be less like weird about sex.
That's always the narrative. Yeah, I mean, I think they're trying to be you're so uncomfortable with your sexuality. So let's just break you in. Let's pop your I hate that term, but that's what he uses all the time. Pop all your internet cherries or whatever. But the strange thing is who cares about that? Who cares if a dad's I don't care if my daughter is going to go on the internet and talk to these dudes. But why do you have to be there for that? Why do you have to initiate her into womanhood or whatever? Why is it the dad's job to be here for that? And I don't know, it's gross.
Yeah.
Which way? I really don't care.
Right. Now Grace is gonna, now she smiles, right? She smiles when she watches this. Then she'll get off stream and she'll act like, what do you think?
Oh Jesus Christ, do you ever
Grace just needs to get on a plane.
You're going
to
lose me. You're going to lose me. I'm going to leave because this sucks. I'll get
2 weeks. Look at this. She already started it. See?
I think Grace is embarrassed here. She's like, what the fuck is... Because anyone else is like, this is psychotic. You know?
This sucks. This is game. Have
fun with men. Ever.
Oh, my God.
Garbage.
Grace, we got guys coming over there. Put them up against the glass for the boys. Come on.
It's the most disgusting thing I've ever heard a man say, really.
Now, Grace has a nice body, but Grace doesn't use it. Grace stays in her house.
Grace, get something instead of those sweatpants.
I'll get something other than sweatpants. I'll be right back.
Yeah, please. Put on fishnets, something.
Look, poor Maxer, let's be honest, okay? She looks at her mother and goes, there's no way I'm ever going to end up like that, physically or – but it's absolutely guaranteed the way she's going. Now,
yeah, she watched
So she's gonna become Courtney
5 to 10 years tops. Yeah,
right. If she doesn't, I don't know, humiliate herself on the internet.
Yeah, that's exactly.
Her mother has maybe 5 to 10 years of this power that she has right now. But she thinks she's got the rest of her
face.
Life and all these
no,
men.
By the way.
No.
Rest,
oh, no,
that all that these men are going to want to chisel away at this belt. Let's do a GoFundMe for a specific article.
Okay, that's fine.
No, Grace, AC/DC.
Look at Ben.
Oh, Rick James is Rick James.
To me, that face that he's making
work for the boys.
Is what? Like.
Sorry, you go. Sorry.
No, I was just gonna say like it, I, watching this, like I immediately was like, this is that face that like the priest is describing, like the lustful look, of like a face that's fixed in this like indescribable smile. Yeah, this kind of like he says like. Staring with this poignant fixity. It just like, yeah, that face of lust is what I see. That's all.
I also see, especially from before, but then here I feel like there's this cringe. He like cringes out, and I think that's why he takes the headphones off. He's embarrassed.
Yeah, he's embarrassed.
And then he hears that, you know, that she's a kinky girl, and I think he realizes that she's probably really embarrassed. You know what I mean?
I think there's just this inkling of a consciousness that he doesn't, I mean, I don't think he has one really, but when it's like this, when he knows that this is being filmed, I'm sure that he's just like, oh, this is the way I look. And he, for a moment, just a second or two, like he gets all self-conscious and embarrassed of himself for a moment.
Sure,
and for Grace. Yeah. Yeah, sure. Totally. But he's so sick. Like he just can't stop himself. I think.
This is a good quote from Hans Guru. Ben usually tries to weaponize Grace's fears against her to make her do what he wants. You were like Courtney. I think that's a good point. Like, you're going to become like Courtney unless you dance around and do what we want on Whoremaxer stream.
Very true.
Okay. So, let's keep going.
Grace wants to probably be a stripper.
I don't think he's happy there. Okay. So we
covered that whole thing about.
Right. I was supposed to read what we just read. Okay. But so we go to the clip next of talking about me. Okay. Sorry.
Through,
sorry.
Mm-hmm. When you actually find out what we've been through that we didn't even know we were going through, it's like, yeah, I mean, you guys got fucked over by the boomers and what they, like, the shit they thought was a good idea,
yeah,
to like liberate themselves and have fun and at Woodstock. It's like we got the shit storm from that, and nobody cared because we were a much smaller group, right? Then the millennials came along and it like is another round of this insanity, right?
Mm-hmm.
That like these millennial guys like RD, no offense, but like what the fuck are you even? I get that you're a product of your culture, but it's so bad. It's even worse than Gen Xers, because at least Gen Xers like have at least some remnants of like masculine banter and whatever, right? Like all those guys that are okay, even though they got the shit kicked out of them, the millennials actually like took it like full on, like straight up. And they suck so much.
Yes. Yeah. 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 Yes.
You know what I mean? They're like incomprehensibly like, moralistic about things that make no sense. And they like absolutely hate masculinity.
All right. So Ben's saying through all this gibberish about eras that millennials like me, I think he's. I'm not trying to sound like some egotist, but he says my name, that people like me are like anti-masculine moralists, you know, mother figures trying to, you know, kind of shake my finger at Ben and saying what he's doing is wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And this will like, I added that in there because it's like, I already, before he even said this, I had written something like, he'll probably say something along those lines about us now, even though he, you know, he already has. So it just kind of validated that point there that he's like talking to, about people like us and what we're saying, you know. And so I think I wanted to just like make a point, like why he obsessively accuses everybody of being deeply envious haters of masculinity is that, you know, the priest is saying to confound lust with virility is like confusing a tumor with the very organ which it devours, a tumor whose very deformity horribly reproduces the shape. So if lust is present, it is always forever threatening to stifle true masculinity and depletes the otherwise healthy faculty with sick abstractions that defeat the purpose of its reason and function, just as it does the intellect. So Ben is always going to present his lust with pride, boasting about it because of how he confuses lust with virility. Ben is boastful and proud of his lust because lust is all that is left of his masculinity, and he can no longer recognize the tumor from the very organ he once had. That's the idea.
Right. Sorry, the cat just jumped up. No, I think that's a great point. Okay. Yes. So, I mean, it connects to all the things we've been reading. Okay, so what's the next clip?
Like,
so,
maybe I'm not playing video.
We are... so obviously, when you look at any anyone who commits sex crimes, this attitude of boastfulness and pride when it comes to lust is an attitude that I believe is sort of shared by many people who do these kinds of things. And we chose to pick out this clip that gave this great example of that. Do you want to roll it? Yeah.
Okay.
Victim here, but maybe I am or whatever.
Is it this one?
No. So.
Oh, I just restarted it. I'm sorry, guys.
Yeah. Okay.
So we're going through. So this is you. This is what you actually said. This is some text. And then. If lust is fret, okay.
I said all this, sorry.
no, sorry.
So this is where this comes from. Like, this is this example that I chose about just somebody else, some other guy who was this pedophile who raped this lady. He basically, it's proven that he bragged about what he did. So that's why.
So this is the next part.
I lost my virginity to a pedophile. I was 15, anorexic. He was 58. He was my teacher. For months, he groomed me and then abused me almost every day. Before school, after school, in my uniform, on the floor. Publicly, he described his crimes as awesome and enviable.
So this is a woman, her name happens to be Grace as well, who her sexual abuser was a teacher, and he actually bragged about his crimes, which is what we're about to see here. We're not saying, by the way, that we have any definitive proof Ben has abused Grace sexually. This is all alleged, and these are just examples of other people we're talking about.
And it's the attitude of being proud, boastful, bragging about your crimes, your lustful crimes, I guess.
Right. So here's actual Facebook comments the sexual abuser posted. Zip up your testicles in the feminist handbag, you sorry little prick. Judging from the emails and tweets I've received, the majority of men in Australia envy me. I was 59, she was 15, going on 25. It was awesome. I had a sexual relationship with a girl who was younger than 17. How many others do this? Go to Muhan or Norfolk and do a door knock and stop trying to stigmatize my association.
I think that very first line of the first tweet, zip up your testicles in the feminist handbag, I think it's like another one of those examples of somebody, like, he's basically saying that kind of same thing. Like, y'all are just haters of my own masculine vibes and like, I'm awesome.
Right. Yes. There's another more from the article about it. More from the article. Is this where? Yes.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, this is the question we kind of come
to. So what happens? Right. This is the kind of end of our chapter one. The final question is, so what happens to virility when lust becomes malignant?
Quote the priest, he says, impotent to create, it can only contaminate in the germ, the frail promise of humanity. He seems to be saying that there is an impotence that results from lust, and nothing is created out of it. It can only contaminate and mutilate the future, threatening to rid itself of any promise of good, threatening to infect and kill what was only growing into being, spreading darkness onto a small kindling of hope already so vulnerable and hardly formed the possibility of decency in this world. That is what is meant by our humanity. It means our purity, gentleness, good-heartedness, tolerance, and mercifulness. In other words, I believe that these are the things we desperately need to create something healthy for the future that can function. And these things are what is threatened by lust.
Right. Incest is the perfect example of how virility is destroyed by lust. If a man lusts after his own child, there's no potential for virility to function. And to go against this is an abomination and a cancer on society.
Yes, and to be proud of such a thing, you'd have to be mad. You'd have to be really sick, sick in the head. And this all makes me so terribly sad to think about how Ben's lust will prevent all of these opportunities in Grace's life. And I think we've seen all kinds of examples already of Grace's behavior that's surely attributed to Ben's lust and madness.
Right. And again, we don't know that there are any alleged crimes happening. We're talking about even in the greater sense of how Ben brags about his behavior of what he did on the Hormaxer stream.
Exactly.
Right. Even if you take the concept of the furthest reaching allegations, what we know and we've seen, I think, is proven here. You know what I mean? In terms of his behavior.
Absolutely.
So I guess.
Okay. So why is she so interested in daddy? She had every opportunity to go sit on Darius's dick, right? Like every other whore, right? She comes running back to me. She didn't give him the time of day. Jeremy, you, why? Why does she come running back to the rapist who beats her and treats her like shit? Why? What's the missing ingredient? Does daddy have a huge dick? No. Can daddy get her pregnant? No. So what is it?
You're infertile too already? Is that? I thought you were supposed to lose it later on in life. Is that true? You're shooting blinks already, Ben?
The only reason Ben, she doesn't get pregnant is because I pull out and spew it on.
Sorry, we cut that clip, but Ben claims all this stuff is a joke. All the stuff he said on Lila's stream is just bullshit, and it's a joke. But I think no matter what, saying that stuff is, I don't know, it's... You can claim it's just him being ironic or something, but I think this line is great. Impotent to create, it can only contaminate, like you said, the germ, the frail promise of humanity. It is probably at the very source, the primal cause of all human blemishes. Do you want to start chapter two?
Yes.
I knew we'd start losing viewers by this time, but thanks for the people that are sticking with us. So Dark Jew says it's obviously a joke. I disagree. I think if you take if Ben was not living with Grace or living with Grace in a more kind of a different context, and then didn't say any of this stuff or said it, it's the conversation that I always have with Ben, which is, if this none of this is true, why do you tell John and everyone that these things, these kind of conversations they had about the oral assault thing, or Grace orally assaults me? Instead, he basically says, I kind of used the wrong language with John, and I did confuse him, because what Grace have and I have is like emotionally incestuous. it's everything becomes this complex thing. But no matter what, I personally don't buy that what's there is an emotionally incestuous relationship that with elements of codependency. But I know, nope, you know, that's all we have. So in terms of what Ben has admitted, but everything else is a joke. So we're going to go to part two, one. Just loading this up. Okay. These are just clips that are playing, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we're using clips from a stream we did with Ava previously, the female philosopher stream, where Grace kind of attacks, or I guess trolls Courtney. Here, let's just watch it.
I think it's pretty plain and simple. We gave all we could. It's time I wake you up.
Grace just poured water on her mother. And by the way, the stream starts with Courtney downstairs doing some work. She was told by Ben, or I guess she talked to Ben about, is it okay if I go downstairs and just watch Hormaxer and do my own thing? It seems like she even recorded it, and Grace comes down and won't let her just chill. That's the context.
Say we're good. No response. From what? The water? Well, the whole thing. Okay, well, I don't think you need more sleep.
Well, I think I need sleep. I'm very tired.
Wait, I gotta this line right here. Courtney is on some type of drug here. No, it's called lack of sleep. She just said it. Sorry.
So you're just gonna sweep like a maniac?
I think this is normal sweeping.
You think it's reasonable to say you've despaired about your kids? And then just do this. Are you gonna cry?
No, I'm not gonna cry.
Wouldn't it make more sense to clean the kitchen with your kids?
It's 10 o'clock. They're tired.
Well, how is walking around the kitchen cleaning and smoking like an alienated person helping anybody?
We're sorry.
Yes, it's clean.
Okay, I like how what Grace is saying is that, sorry, we're dealing with our crazy dog, something we'll always have to deal with. Our dog is named Una. Grace says that Courtney is cleaning like an alienated person. How much of this is being gassed up by the audience? I mean, you could rewatch the stream, but it's like right at the beginning. Is the stream begins with Grace doing this. And to me, you know, this is all the behest of Ben, or Ben saying, go troll your mom and you'll feel better. But there's a lot of kind of stuff going on, but I just think, I don't, I feel like gaslighting is an overused term, but like the idea of telling Courtney she's crazy because she's simply cleaning the house up, telling her to clean the house with the kids, even though it's like 10 p.m.
But I mean,
I was having a great time before you came down. Okay, because I thought we would just do this.
Because you're tired? Because the baby's tired. Big, fat, stupid baby's tired.
Number one, Courtney's playing a recording because she's trying to explain to Grace that Ben okayed this idea to go downstairs, clean, and chill out. And instead, she plays the recording to prove, no, I'm supposed to be down here. This is the life that Courtney was living, where Ben was literally giving her the okay to chill out. And then Grace comes down and sprays her with water again.
And, you know, go on to score.
Well, then I'm just going
to
go.
You're just going to go?
Yeah.
Why? Because you don't like it being filmed? How stupid you are?
Yeah, that's pretty much it.
Did rant like you just?
Real. It's not real. You gotta say it a different way. You gotta say it in a different way.
Oh, are you triggered? Are you gonna go run away? Cry? You gonna go run away? be a philosopher in your car. Bye, mommy. I thought you cared so much about your kids. Bye. Loser.
Okay. Courtney, we need to explain the time jump. Courtney left in her car because she felt attacked. She was called a loser. She was basically said that she was abandoning the children, even though Ben was at the house. And then what you guys didn't see is that Courtney was coaxed back to the house by Grace. Grace called her on stream multiple times and then tells her to go talk to chat, go talk to Hormaxer. And Courtney's talking to Hormaxer for some reason. And Hormaxer, sorry, dealing with our dog. She loves us too much. Hormaxer is just being an idiot and telling Courtney a bunch of gross sexual stuff. And Courtney didn't know that one of her kids was behind her because she was told to sit and talk to Hormaxer.
I don't think so. And that's going to help. I was leaving her alone.
She was leaving her alone.
So what's the problem?
I don't think it wasn't good enough. Public calls like this
from... Okay. Hormaxer, I'm going to go.
You could tell Joe to go to bed. I don't think it makes any sense. It's
I did
not
tell him to go to bed, and you said, don't tell him to go to bed. You have no right so to now tell you him have to go.
Oh, we should have shown this clip. Sorry, guys. But great. Courtney told their youngest kid to go to bed, and Grace said, you don't have any right to tell him to go to bed. And that's a whole thing with them. I'm sure people would know. And Courtney was just kind of like left standing there.
It's actually explicit.
Now Grace is mad at her.
Conversation in front of him. Retard. You know better than that.
I didn't know Joe was behind me.
Yes, you did.
No, I didn't. And?
You didn't know. No, that's a lie. Okay. That is a damn lie. Mm-hmm. You didn't know Joey was right there behind you?
No, I can't see him. Look. Look at the screen.
Turn your head around. He's right there. You saw him! I'm not saying it's a big deal, but I'm just saying that's a lie.
My ex, Hollywood.
Okay. So, obviously, double kind of physical stuff that happens. I don't know if you'd call it abuse, but physical things happening. Grace gets really mad when Courtney said, you told me that I couldn't tell Joey to go to bed. Grace, I think, I don't want to say the wrong thing, but I think she knew that Joey was in there when she told Courtney to get on with Hormaxer. And then, you know, the moment Courtney says, well, hey, I didn't know he was behind me. I'm looking at this computer. She gets this kind of physical thing that happens. And then here's just one more clip of physical stuff that happens to Courtney from Grace.
Ben Thorp, my ex Hollywood Ben Thorp, my ex Hollywood Ben Thorp. It's just like, it's coming.
Ow, fucking bitch. Get up. My screen. Okay.
You can hear Ben. Oh, oops, I fucked that up. You can hear Ben laughing, by the way, when that happens.
Am I right? Let's see here. Here's my idea.
Do we stop here? Sorry.
We can add a little bit of context, yeah.
Yeah. So we stop here? Sorry, Amelia edited all these.
There's just like a couple more, but that's it.
Okay, so keep playing.
Sure. Do you want to explain a little bit though? Like
This next part?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I would say this next part is a different context. There's a lot going on here, but the next part is this is when I think Ben was expecting there to be a divorce. And so to hide the money that he had, because Ben had a lot, many hundreds of thousands of dollars, I should say Ben and Courtney, because they are still married. So to hide that money, Ben gave Grace the money that she still has. And the whole idea was Grace is being paid back for stuff she did, which she did take care of the kids. I think we can all agree she was maybe parentified. Even Courtney would agree and took care of the kids too much as the oldest daughter. But the point is, Ben gives Grace the money. Come on, let's admit it, to hide the money if there's a divorce. I don't know if that would work. And there's this weird manipulation that's happening where Ben is basically like Grace deserves the money, Courtney, don't you agree? And we'll only get money from Grace if we do streaming. Of course Ben controls the money. Grace isn't gonna, but there's this weird, Ben is playing like this weird character. Let's just watch it.
Let's say there's a certain amount of money that supposedly is Dad's money, right?
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah.
My idea is if you tally up the years for 10 to 12 hours a day.
Was it my money?
That I was a live-in nanny. The years of.
Hold on. I just want to talk about this comment. I mean, all I can say is the family put all of this on the internet for all of us to see over the last year. Why wouldn't we talk about it? This is one of the most insane cases of the modern world I think we've ever seen. This is, someone wrote, this is like the Kardashians. This is the new Kardashians in that families are going to start putting themselves, and they already do, on the internet and showing it for the world to see. Not only that, but I think if Grace was away from Ben, I'm sorry, this is my opinion, I probably would have less to say about it, but I feel like she's in the middle of being in an unhealthy relationship. That's my opinion. Grace is an adult. She's free to do whatever she wants. But I would like to talk about, and so would Amelia, our connection and thoughts on what we're seeing in front of us. So, not trying to get mad, but just information.
Cleaning Airbnbs.
Yes.
The years of waitressing shifts when I was a child. If you put all that together, and plus marriage counseling, frankly, for you two idiots.
Right.
If you put all that together, I think that money is my money that you
own. Yeah.
So basically the idea is that's money is Grace's, and that she should be paid the hundreds of thousands of dollars. Maybe if it was a good faith conversation, but let's not even pretend it was. Let's see.
Yeah.
Are we going into this part next, or do we have reading to do? You gotta unmute.
I was just saying this is a little shorter bit. Sorry.
Okay.
Yeah, like seriously, I don't think women mind like if they get a slap or, you know, just like a, not a beating, but like, you know, limited violence. Yeah. Okay.
I mean,
we showed some of this yesterday.
Asking me that? Mm-hmm. Like, I think it's pretty clear that like I wasn't able to do what I said that I could do, and I've made a huge wreck of everything, but I'm glad all of you guys exist. I'm glad I had all of you guys, and I wouldn't take it back. So like, I don't know, like I fucked up. I shouldn't have gotten married, but like, I'm glad that God let me get married. So.
So manipulative. It's just so, I'm so sick of you crying on my streams. Fine, you want to leave? Fine, go ahead and leave. I don't care. Ugh. Why do you cry in front of me? I don't get it. I don't get it.
Okay, so, I mean, I think contextually, though, what Courtney said, we have to kind of give the background to, which is the idea that Courtney didn't follow her vow of being married to Ben, even though they've never explained how Courtney didn't follow her vows as a wife. And that everything was her fault, not Ben, not Grace, everything was her fault. But I think Courtney cries and is basically like, I love having you kids. I love creating you guys no matter what. And that's the reaction. And again, all of this was put on the internet for everyone to give thoughts about and consume. Ben said the reason he wanted them to be online, this was the interview I did with him, that they were more, or maybe it was in a chat, that they're more honest. That by putting it all online, people are more honest. So we're just, these are our thoughts about what's been put on the internet. I don't know if this is Ben or Grace. You're not helping, you're just perpetuating drama. Whatever the internal problems in this family may be, don't act like you're doing this for the greater good. You have female genetics. I don't know, guys, that might be Ben, the female genetics part, but maybe not. But I think again, This doesn't make me angry to see, but I think I don't understand why we can't talk about our thoughts about the family. Okay. So is there readings to do, my love?
Yes. And this is all just commenting, making comments on the fact that, like, whatever we're seeing Grace in her behavior, you know, it's very likely it's all attributed to Ben and his own madness, his own like logic and stuff like that. So there's good reason why we see Grace doing these things, even though they seem really out there and weird and cruel at times. So this next part, we're jumping into the Diary of a Country Priest again, and I just wanted to shortly talk about this subplot that exists within the Diary of a Country Priest.
To give it context.
Mm-hmm. So there are these characters in the book that, in my opinion, have a striking resemblance to the Thorp family, or at least Ben, Courtney, and Grace. Yes. So in the book, there is the priest is obviously the main character, but he's recording in his diary all of these distressing encounters with this dysfunctional family. So we have the Count, who's the father, Madame Comte, who is his estranged wife and mother of their daughter, Mademoiselle Chantal. And through their confessions, it is disclosed to the priest that the daughter, Chantal, has been having an affair with her own father for years. The mother knew about this and suffered in silence. Chantal, the daughter, is poisoned against her mother and wants to see her mother dead.
Mm.
So Chantal, the daughter, shows up to the church unannounced, and she kind of just looks really upset and angry.
Okay.
He says, "She was waiting for me at the sacristy door. I knew it. Her face, her thin face was even more contorted than the day before yesterday, and there was that fold on the lips, sneering and hard."
For a second, can I get the, do I have the right page here? It's,
yes. Yes.
Okay.
Cool. Go to the next.
The next page?
Yeah, we're on that one now.
Okay, thank you. Sorry.
I said, "You know I can't receive you here. Go home." Her glance frightened me, and I never thought myself a coward. Heavens, the hatred in her voice. And those eyes so proud and shameless, so one can hate without shame. "Mademoiselle," I said, "I'll do what I promised for you. Today? Today. Because tomorrow, monsieur, it would be too late. She knows I went to the presbytery. She knows everything that goes on, that sly beast. I used to not be on my guard. Her eyes grow upon me, grow upon one. They appear good and kind. Now I'd like to tear her eyes out. I would, yes, stamp on them like that. How could you?"
Is she talking about her mother here?
Yes. Chantal is talking about her mother and how she'd like to stomp on her eyes. He asks her, "How could you say these things in front of the church, a few steps from the Blessed Sacrament? Have you no fear of God?" Then she says, "I'll kill her," she said. "I'll kill her and I'll kill myself. You'll have to try and explain that away to your God someday." So this is just kind of showing the level of hatred and anger and hurt that this girl has been pushed to say these kinds of things about her own mother. She even says, "I'll kill her or I'll kill herself. I wish."
Which we'll see later, Grace has said before, at the behest of her father.
Right. Exactly. So that's all it was. It just reminded me of this hatred that Ben tries to instill Grace with. Yeah.
Should I play the clips here?
Yes.
Okay.
"And I want hey, when she meets her maker, I want stuff to be accounted for.
She should be, and she I'm should sure be publicly crucified for doing that, because I remember when she turned my relationship with you into this like this thing where she's like, I bet you're doing something weird. Totally changes the relationship. You can't, it's just like, you're sexualizing it. She's sexualizing it with a 14-year-old girl. My sister, she's trying to do the same thing to me. She's trying to like make her totally like mistrust everything. It, she should be like publicly beaten and killed for that.
Yeah, I think so.
I am going to fucking fuck my mom's shit up so that I want to drive her to the camera. Suicide. Well, I would like to drive her to suicide.
So suicide
or
gross.
For her to tell the truth.
All right.
Okay.
Yeah. I don't care what.
Okay. So yeah, she goes on to say, Chantal says, you can send me to hell for all I care. I pretended not to hear. What was the use? Mademoiselle, I said, I'm not going on with this talk here in the middle of the church.
I'm trying to find, I'm so sorry. I'm trying to find the, sorry. Okay, here it goes. Sorry, had to find the page.
There's only one place where I can hear you. I drew her gently to the confessional. She knelt of her own accord. I do not wish to confess, she said. I'm not asking you to. You need only remember that these wooden walls have known so much shame that they are as though injured. You may be a young lady of gentle birth, but pride here is a sin like any other. A little more dirt on the muck heap. Enough of that, she said. You know perfectly well, I only want justice. And what do I care about dirt? Dirt is to be humiliated as I am. Since that horrible woman, she's talking here about her father's new mistress. Right. Since that horrible woman came into the house, I've eaten more dirt than bread. Those are words you've picked up in novels. You're only a child. Why can't you talk like a child? A child. I stopped being a child long ago. I know all there is to be known now. I know enough to last me the rest of my life. Keep calm. I am calm, a lot calmer than you. Mm. So here we just like...
Do you want me to read the description of what...
Sure, yes.
So it says, Chantal describes how she would spy on her father and his new mistress having sex from outside her his bedroom window. She says she can tell they will get rid of her soon. Then she talks about how her mother's fine with her going to live in England with her cousins, who she believes are proper, but she is looking to get rid of her too. When the priest tries to interrupt her, she says something so vile the priest couldn't repeat it in his diary. He summed up by saying that he says that her miserable mother had not known how to protect her joy, her life, and that she was a fool and a coward. So that's kind of what is here, right?
Yes.
I mean, is there anything? So should we play the clip next?
Actually, let me read this first.
Okay. 146.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So it starts with, what could I?
Yeah.
What could I say?
What could I say? What could I do to help this wounded creature whose life seemed to be flowing away from some secret hurt? In spite of all I felt, I had better remain silent a little longer. Run the risk of it. I had found a little strength to pray. She was silent, too. I came out of confessional. She had risen before me. We found ourselves face to face, but I could not recognize my vision. She was extremely, almost absurdly pale. Her hands were trembling. I can't stand anymore, she said in a childish voice. Why did you look at me like that? Can't you leave me alone? Her eyes were dry and burning. I did not know how to reply. I led her slowly to the church door. If you loved your father, you would not be in this terrible state of revolt. You call that love? I don't love him anymore, she replied. I think I hate him. I hate them all. Words hissed through her lips, and she gave a gasp at the end of each sentence, a gasp of disgust or weariness, I hardly know. I don't want you to take me for a little fool, she said now, with self-sufficient pride. Mother thinks I know nothing of life, as she puts it. I tell you, I'd have to be blindfolded. Why, our servants are a set of gossiping monkeys, and she thinks them perfect, a most reliable lot. She chose them, of course, but I should have been sent away to a boarding school by the time I was 10, perhaps before. There wasn't much I didn't know. I was terribly upset and disgusted, of course, but I accepted it as one makes up one's mind to illness and death and many other horrible things one must be resigned to. There was my father, you see. He was everything to me, a master, a king, a god, and a friend, a very good friend. He always used to talk to me when I was little. Yep. He treated me almost like an equal. I wore a locket next to my heart with his picture and a lock of his hair. Mother never understood him. She, don't speak of your mother. You do not love her. And anyhow, go on, say what you've got to say. I hate her. I've always hated. Hold your tongue. No doubt invisible spirits of evil lurk in all homes, even Christian homes. The most vicious of them has been growing in your heart for a long time now, and you didn't know. So I just added this part to showcase, you know, this is the one part where Chantal really gives this sort of confession and deliberately talks about her father in this way, that he was her good friend and equal, and that she kind of had this loving relationship with him. Yeah.
And that she hates her mother.
Yes. And that, you know, I like the last line, no doubt evil spirit, invisible spirits of evil lurk in all homes, even Christian homes.
Yes.
And the most vicious of them has been growing in your heart for a long time now, and you didn't know. So I think that's the thing, is like, there's all of this rage and hatred.
In Grace.
Yes. And little do you realize that it is this thing growing in you that isn't yours. It's, you know, attached itself to you somehow. And you might not even realize that this hatred that you feel for your mother is something you should be careful for or worry about for yourself.
For your soul.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you can play the next clip now.
Okay.
Hey, online. I love my dad. He's a great guy. We're like best friends.
That was that.
Yeah. I didn't have these.
No, wait, pause. Sorry. Okay,
that was a quick one.
Okay. Yeah, I'll just say this part before this next clip, but all the better, she said, let it grow horrible, let it grow to be horrible and hideous. I have no more respect for my father now. I've lost faith in him, and I don't care about anything else. He's deceived me. One can deceive a daughter just as well as a wife. It's not the same, it's worse, but I'll have my revenge. I'll run away to Paris. I'll disgrace myself. And I'll write and say, that's what you've made me. Then he'll suffer what I've suffered. So the next clips is kind of like the equal that I could find of Grace saying this kind of stuff, that, you know, I'll go out and disgrace myself, as this kind of reaction to her being kept and parentified by her mom.
Mm-hmm. I didn't fuck up. And yeah, mom, you fucked up. Now fix it. I'm not okay with you just leaving. It's not my mess to clean up. It's not my mess to clean up. And you think I'm just gonna clean it up? No, it's gonna be a fucking disaster. I want to go out. I want to have sex with whoever I want to have sex with. I want to party. I want to spend a ton of money. I hate it. I hate all of this shit of me coming to this fucking house that my mother fucking made dirty, and then fucking looking around and saying, how am I going to clean this up? I hate it. I'm going to waste my youth if I don't get out of this fucking cycle. I hate it. I'm gonna go, it's been 5 years now. I was 15, now I'm 20. And it's gonna be, what am I gonna be, 25, 30, 45? I'm gonna be doing this fucking shit.
You've been through this.
Oops. Yeah. Oh, I can't hear you either. You're muted, my love.
Whoops. Oh, I did it too. Okay, to give context to that, that was Grace doing a rage video that, you know, Ben probably got her in, you know, whipped into a frenzy about. But at the time, Courtney wasn't at the house. She was getting away from Ben, in my opinion. And Grace was, I think there's two kind of layers to it, that she really was angry and sad at what her life had become. If you watch the whole thing, mm-hmm. I think also it was trying to get Courtney back in the house too. But sure. Ultimately, it relates to the text, I think, pretty well.
Well, either way, it's like this manipulation. Like, I want this reaction, and mm-hmm. To do that, I'm willing to disgrace myself or whatever. It's just to get a reaction out of her mom,
right? Which in the book, there's a kind of it's a similar idea that's reinforced that this kind of hatred won't help Grace at all. Mm-hmm. Maybe she even knows that now. I know she kind of goes back and forth with it, but anyway, let's go to the next.
Okay. I thought for a while it seemed I could read other words on her lips as she was speaking, words to which she gave no voice, yet they burnt their way, one by one, into my brain, so that I called out, almost in spite of myself, "You won't do that. I know you're not tempted that way." She began to shake so violently that she had to lean with both hands against the wall for support. And another strange thing happened, which, again, I can only recount without attempting to explain. It might have been a shot in the dark, yet I knew I was right. "Give me that letter in your bag at once." She made no attempt to resist. She just sighed deeply and held out the envelope with a shrug. "You must be the devil," she said. So this is a very significant part of the book because it's almost as if the priest can psychically tell that this young girl who's in distress, Chantal, has this suicide letter in her pocket, which he had no idea about. So he kind of takes a shot in the dark, that's what he calls it, and asks for the letter. And she gives it to him. And then she says, "You must be the devil," because it's like he just kind of did this magic trick in front of her. And so she left quickly, and she's running through the graveyard as the priest is chasing her. And then he finally catches up to her and they come face to face. "I think it was the first time I really looked into the face of a woman. Not that I usually avoid them, and sometimes I have found them attractive, but without being as scrupulous as some of my colleagues. I know too well the malice surrounding me not to observe the indispensable reserve of a priest. Now I was carried away by curiosity. I am not ashamed of it. I think it must have been the curiosity of a soldier who will take the chance outside the trench to see the enemy face to face at last. Or possibly, I remember when I was 7 or 8 going with my grandmother to see an old cousin who had just died. I was left alone in the room, and in just the same way, I lifted up the shroud to take one look at that face. Some faces are open and unsullied. Purity shines through them. Doubtless, the face under my eyes had once been thus, and now it had become in some way closed, impenetrable. Purity was there no longer, but neither anger, disdain, nor shame had yet been able to efface the mysterious hallmark. They were only so many grimaces. An unusual, almost alarming nobility of expression bore witness to the power of evil, of sin, that sin which was not her own. God, are we really such wretched creatures that a proud soul in revolt must need turn against itself? You are helpless, I told her. We were standing at the very end of the courtyard near the little door, which leads to the Casimir's orchard. That derelict corner where the grass is so tall that it hides the graves forgotten there for the last century. Another priest might have refused to hear you out. I have listened, so be it. But I shall not accept your challenge. God accepts no challenge. So,
So what's going on there?
So he's describing that the priest, Bernanos, loves doing this. He loves describing faces. And so the priest is describing Chantal's face and all of her degrees of agony and how sad she is. He's speaking about this facial expression that she made, that she's making, and he's trying to pinpoint this. He's trying to understand the cause of where this particular expression comes from. And he describes this as an unusual, almost alarming nobility of expression. He is saying that Chantal is so natural about her cruelty and hate that her facial expression is one of strength, pride, or nobility. Her face is so hardened by witnessing the power of evil, of sin, which was not her own, but her father's. And that's the expression that came across. And this is what I have to say. Having hate without shame gives someone like Grace relentless power, an apparent confidence and defiance. This madness, the parasitic sin of her father, gives her the ability to be so natural and shameless in her cruelty and hate. In the same way Ben conflates lust with virility, Grace conflates this naturalness and shamelessness of hate and cruelty with self-confidence and high self-esteem. And it is for the same reason that Ben is proud of his lust, Grace is also proud of her hate. And we've seen Ben in many different streams take hours to build up and instill Grace with this confounded sense of self-confidence by encouraging her to be as shameless as he is when it comes to hating her mother, and as natural as he is when it comes to inflicting pain on her mother. He uses
these confidence boosting pep talks conflated to shameless hate and cruelty, and uses this against her mother Courtney and attacks her relentlessly with it. I believe a huge part of why he got Grace into this relationship with him is because he wanted Courtney to know about it and suffer in pain and silence. Boasting about his lust as he does, I believe he wants this endlessly because he takes a certain sadistic pleasure in using his own daughter in these ways as a pawn. I think we know that Grace will post even texts she sends her mom and tortures her with. It doesn't even sound like Grace half the time. It sounds like Ben, you know, this complete intense anger and hatred. So do you want to go to the clip?
Yes.
For hundreds of thousands of hours. It's go time.
Yeah.
I'm going to push you. I'm going to look forward to you squirming until I've exhausted every moral means of making you squirm.
They're talking about Courtney, by the way, and making her suffer.
And we'll see. Yeah. Are you alive, dead?
It sounds good.
In jail, or actually, like, have you told the truth? And I don't think you know the answer to that. That's the thing. Like,
yes.
People like Lala will say, "Well, just do the math." How do you do the math?
I don't know. I don't know.
And it'll be fun. I don't understand why it wouldn't be fun to make this loser squirm, writhe, just laugh, and then another round of it. Yes. Oopsie.
No more pussy shit. Yeah. Kino content. Am I right, Lalo?
But she's banking. She's banking that the ugliness, just the pure ugliness of what she's done to you, is going to shut you down as a human being. You played your cards wrong, and now watch us lay down hand after hand after hand after hand, where you lose every hand and it spirals. Fun with dad.
That sounds
good. And it will inspire other men to go, "Hey, why don't I talk to my daughter about that? Let's have some fun."
It'll inspire other men.
And we'll see how long mom lasts before maybe this bitch needs a little bit of fun from dad and his lovely daughter, allying themselves with each other and saying, "You know what? I don't give a fuck about your anger."
Yeah.
Or die trying. I don't care. She could try to kill us.
Yeah.
I think
she can't do anything. It's retarded. I'm not
that shot her shot. And now it's just, I tell you, it's fun to kick the living shit out of someone who deserves it. I don't know what's wrong with that.
You know, I've never really done that. No. Kick,
and they see the, and you just kick them again.
Okay. So that was just to iterate. Can you pause? My point. that I believe that Ben wants this endlessly. He even says it went round after round after round of this punishment. And if it takes you all of your energy in life, like, so be it. Die trying. That's what he's kind of saying there. So, yeah, you can keep going.
Yeah. I'm saying it actually in this case, you have more of a, like a vested interest. You have literally been abused by your mother from the first moment you were conceived, including your conception. You were used as a tool to manipulate me and manipulate. You were manipulated also in the pursuit of this horrendous. To me, that's only 20 years of my life. That's the entirety of your life. And you're saying, well, I'm not sure if I want to like sort of seek justice here or turn the tables. I have now been accused of committing incest with my father, of stealing money,
lying
about a legal issue. What infamies haven't you been accused of by when you've never done any of these things?
No.
And so you're saying, well, I don't want to help. This is being help dad out. Why wouldn't you seek to get retribution on this person?
Yeah.
Who's done this to you? Why wouldn't you be motivated to do this? Your entire being is like hinging on this. Why wouldn't you want to fight back against someone who's done such horrendous things? And you sat there with her. You dropped out of high school to help her. You sat there with her day after day after day.
By the way, what, Grace didn't sit with Ben? Grace didn't sit in the room with Ben? I mean, let's really know the context of this. That you know, Ben started, you know, whatever you want to call it, giving attention to Grace in 2018. He's blaming this on Courtney, that she dropped out, she stayed at home only because of Courtney and not because of Ben.
It makes me think that, that dropping out of school is something that, you know, she is kind of bummed about, and he's like utilizing that. Obviously, like, why, if she wasn't upset about it, why would he kind of use this to like amp her up? Like, you dropped out of high school for her. Obviously, that's not true, but like, it's just pretty weird.
Yeah. Oops. Sorry, guys.
I can carry it. You can submit. I don't think that's against.
Is this the right clip? I know I might.
I don't think that's against.
Yes.
Morality,
you're right.
And no, you know, see if the juices don't start flowing. And but if you have a problem logically, I don't, you know, you're welcome to shoot holes in it and say, like, okay, I don't think you're gonna find a way around this of like quote moving on.
I'm saying at the end of the day,
do I pause here?
Actually, I'm a little lost, but I think we're on the right track.
Okay. Do you want to, let's see, do you want to read this next part, or we're just going to keep playing it?
I'm just trying to, I think we're still in this thing. Mm-hmm. We hear Ben, you know, he's just like having these confidence boosting pep talks still of
to Grace.
Yeah. And we haven't reached it yet. So we keep playing. I think we're still.
Stay. I want her to say either she has to tell the truth or she has to kill herself, because otherwise she's going to be like, she's just going to keep having people say, like, you need to tell the truth.
Days ago, I realized that she has been pretending to be her mother in order to protect her mother. I called her out on it. I'm like, you're not even really like your mother at all. You don't have these problems. You're not afraid of me. It's bullshit. And actually, she responded. Actually, quite vivaciously, she was like, yeah, I don't know what I'm doing. And I got trolled too to respond as if her mother is an incompetent loser. Grace is not an incompetent loser.
Oh, yeah, she's
whatever you
want
to say, she has problems. She's not a
exactly
shriveled up 51-year-old, you know, semi dyke, you know, right? So, like, she's Grace can do things, she's good streamer, she's a vivacious person. She's a beautiful young woman. She's has high self-esteem. Why is she acting like this fucking loser? That is her mother coming. And I'm like, why?
I think it's really interesting. Here he says he means confidence, and all this confidence he's instilling her is conflated to shameless hate and cruelty to use to attack her mother. So like you said before, he's building her up so that this is instilled in her head, saying essentially, dad loves me, dad thinks all these great things about me. Mm-hmm. And the answer to show dad I love him or to defend myself
is to
attack Courtney at all times.
To me, like you just said, I do believe this is Ben trying to hand her the way to give him the ultimate gesture of her love. So I think it would be this ultimate gesture of love when Grace does attack her mom and does what he says. And in a way that is a humiliation thing. Like, we'll get to more of that maybe like later, but definitely for like a future stream, those are things I'd like love to talk about. So I think like here, you know, he's saying something along the lines of, go ahead, offend your mother, stop protecting her by preventing yourself from being natural, shameless, and confident. But I can see that through Ben's manipulation, Grace sees it that it's her mother's fault, that her confidence is conflated with cruelty, a projection maybe of Courtney onto Grace. But in my opinion, this couldn't be further from the truth. Maybe Grace frames it as being herself offends her mother. Therefore, she sees it, Courtney sees it as cruelty, that she's pretty or confident or whatever. Therefore, she has negatively been affected. And this has negatively affected Grace's self-esteem and confidence, discouraging her and shaming her for being prettier than her or naturally herself. And I said, if this were true, it's really not clear to us. And if this were true, why has Ben so adamant about Grace taking her rage and directing it to the source of her anger?
Okay. Yeah.
Why am I yelling at you? You're not this person. And then like, why are you acting like this person? And the answer is because you don't want to offend your mother by being the beautiful, vivacious, successful young woman that you can be. What the fuck?
So the next...
I've invested 5 years of my life in putting up with the unbelievable chaos of Grace being with me to like help her, rescue her in this series of attacks. I'm saying, okay, sweetheart, let's get up now and fight back. I haven't invested this 5 years so that you can then go, I'm defeated as a human being.
So it's like Ben is saying like, no, you have to go after your mom. I haven't built this up in you to hate Courtney, to not, because I think Grace is torn because she loves Courtney and loves her mom. And I think there's that part of her that isn't completely hating Courtney, but Ben just, you know, he's always trying to kind of go like, Hey, look at me. Don't you see what this is really about? Get back to what I'm telling you, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I've been okay. Yeah. Taking one hit after the next, you turning your anger towards me while not intending to, but now like, take it and direct it to the source of
your anger.
You have every right to be angry at your mother. I don't have any Christian message to you to like move on.
Mm-hmm. No Christian message to move on. Although it seems like Grace, when she talked to Mr. Earl, she was saying that to him, but it seems like it always, that's so strange, you know, but do you want to read this next part?
Mm-hmm. you know, all that we see really here is that Ben does invest a lot of time and energy into instilling Grace with a sense of confidence and shamelessness when it comes to how she should feel about her mother. But the whole time we do see Grace struggling to muster up this rage that she needs and the pride that she would need to be cruel and naturally that way. She seems resigned, saying all of this really fucked up stuff while kind of forcing herself to have these emotions, raising her voice here and there. And she's just kind of regurgitating Ben's words. I think that she's embarrassed, especially in front of Lalo. I think she got embarrassed, like Ben in in front of Lalo as this kind of tactic of isolating her, is trying to get her to say really fucked up stuff in front of him. Like, I'm driven to kill my mother. And I think, like, she deeply, the reason why she's not able, because we've seen her angry. We've seen her on streams talking about her mom, and she does muster up that rage while she's talking about her mom. But in this case, we don't. She's having a really hard time pleasing Ben by showing how mad she is. Keep rolling. She says that right here.
Are not vengeance.
No, I don't care what this person says. I don't care if somebody says it's vengeance. I don't care. The only problem I have is.
Is?
Oh, is what?
I guess I'm just sort of like, this is a waste of my time. I should just move on. Not that it's a problem to get justice, but
okay.
Like.
Wait. Okay.
I'm not invested in it. I don't care. I don't like. It's not that I don't care. It's that emotionally.
She's lying. Okay,
you don't
great.
Care about what?
So
it's not that Ben. I don't care. I don't have the right emotions. I'm not angry. Why do I not like? Why can't I say the same thing as you say, Dad? Like, fuck that bitch. Let's get her in jail. I can say it, but you obviously know that I don't.
Yeah, but
she doesn't mean it. Grace is saying, "Look, Dad, I don't mean it. I don't want to put my mom in jail." There's that part, that spark in her that I think knows that this is wrong and that Courtney isn't an evil abuser who destroyed the family. Mm-hmm. Right? And that maybe some of that blame should go to Ben for, you know, making the kids listen to him talk about how awful Courtney is for 6 hours a day or a million other things. But it's just interesting. Grace can't do it because that feeling's not there. Do you want to call it brainwashing? Do you want to call it instilling it into her? I don't know.
When you get that, like when you send her something and you get left on read, like don't tell me it doesn't like go right up your ass. It does.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, but you're afraid that if you tap into your anger, that it will like ruin your life. I don't think it will.
Stop there. Yeah. So in my opinion, the truth is that I think it would, and I think it will. It will ruin your life if you tap into this rage. It's already sort of happened that way. This is what we're watching happening. We're watching a parent encouraging homicidal rage and calling it confidence, strength, and nobility. Ben is doing a really good job of destroying Grace's moral compass by discouraging her emotions and hesitations by calling it weakness. It's clear like she has the right mind. She doesn't want to do this stuff. It's ridiculous.
I agree. Do you want to keep going?
Yeah, keep going.
But I just feel weak because it shouldn't matter. Like, I don't know. It's like, if I focus on like driving her crazy to get justice, which would make sense. It's like, okay, well now I'm paying attention to her again and I'm likely to be, it doesn't necessarily, like, it doesn't have to be out of control. It can just be like a controlled effort.
Mm-hmm. Grace knows deep down how pointless it all is, how irrational it is to continue to pay attention to driving her mom crazy to get justice. This is her true feelings, and they hinder her from accessing the rage that Ben wants her to have. The pride she needs to be able to see how clearly justified her anger really is, how much pain it warrants, and the exact source of it, the target. Grace confuses her own intuition, which tells her how irrational this is, and tells herself that that is her feelings and intuition which are irrational. So it's like she's saying, no, 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 I'm wrong. I should hate my mom more. I'm being weird for not hating her more, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay, so we're going to come back to this video in a little bit in the next chapter. We see how Grace is just regurgitating the words her dad did the night before. On the Avis stream, Grace talks about Win-Win, the ultimate extent of her pride. Okay, so.
And your mom didn't. I know you're reading your mom's.
We're talking about how Grace stripped in the woods for her dad after she snuck out of Jeremy a person from Seattle that she had gone to visit. We saw a clip of this already, but Grace was freaked out by this guy, Jeremy. She walked, she went out of, she called her dad about it. He told her to go through a window, go in the middle of the woods at night and strip and take pictures for him. That's what Ben told her to do.
Big comment. You liked stripping in the woods for your dad.
I understood it as humiliation. Yes, I understood.
Okay.
It.
Mm-hmm. So you're okay with that. And your mom wasn't. In the video, I feel like we watched, was your mom fighting against it, saying, I don't like the way you're treating me. And there's, it's like these two things just don't work. And you're caught in the middle. No wonder.
Well, if she didn't, no, if she didn't like the way he was treating her, then why didn't she just leave? I mean, it works for me. It works for me. I've got a great dad who obviously loves me and cares about me deeply. Mm-hmm. And, you know, everybody envies it and is constantly talking about us. How does it not work for me?
Okay, obviously, so right, it works for me. You.
Obviously, I'm well loved. Obviously,
wait, you think people and you think people envy it?
Yes, I do.
Yeah. Okay, well, so.
Oh, okay.
No.
Pause.
Yes. Okay. It's hard for me to hear that stuff and like be like, how could she say that without any of this stuff being true? Like the pride part, taking pride in it. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think that, and this is like a kind of harsh take, but I think Ben has made her believe that whatever has happened between them is a sort of very unique thing that in a way Ben has told her you've benefited from this. In fact, you could be set for life if you really go out on the internet and go out on a limb and really express this kind of stuff openly.
Wait, speaking of, we're talking about alleged incest, right?
Yeah. And I'm not saying anything happened. It's hard for me to believe that you can have this pride in something if you haven't even done it. Like, what is there to be proud of? And also, yeah, I think that if it did happen, it is sort of benefiting her. You could say, you know, she has all of this line of reason. I have all the control, all the money. She won her father's affection, but
it's not. It's right. It's not benefiting her at all. She's in a very fucked up place.
Yeah, and like I want to mention when Grace went to LA and she was hanging out with Darius and Relly and Nadush. They were walking on like the pier at one point, and Relly and Grace got into this argument, and it was sort of like, what example are you leading, or something like that. And she says something like, God blessed me with a very unique life. And something about that just like caught my attention. Like, it's just this kind of idea, like, this is all it makes you unique in terms of like your influence that you're able to have now. Like, you can go and talk about, I mean, she does say that I can go and talk about how dysfunctional my family is. That's something that's really unique that nobody else has. So
yeah,
in a way, it sounds like Ben, like, this is just a way for him to be like, this has benefited you some way. You're not a victim. You're actually some kind of influencer because of it.
Right. Okay. Do you want to set up the next?
Yes, I would. Yeah, totally.
So what's this next reading about?
So the priest is still having this confrontation with Chantal. He asks her, or she demands that he give her back the letter, and he refuses. He tells her not to use the word love because she has lost all connection to it. Mm. And then he goes on to say, all sins are alike, but there is only one sin. I'm not speaking to you in riddles. Such truths are within the reach of the humblest Christian, if only he be willing to receive them from us. The world of sin confronts the world of grace like the reflected picture of a landscape in the blackness of very still deep waters. there is not only a communion of saints, there is also a communion of sinners. In their hatred of one another, their contempt, sinners unite, embrace, intermingle, become as one. One day in the eyes of eternal God, they will be no more than a mass of perpetual slime over which the vast tide of divine love, that sea of living, roaring flame which gave birth to all things, passes vainly. Who are you to condemn another's sin? He who condemns sin becomes a part of it, espouses it. You hate this woman, your mother, and feel yourself so far removed from her. When your hate and her sin are as two branches of the same tree, who cares for your quarrels? Mere empty gestures, meaningless cries, spent breath. Come what may, death will soon have struck you both to silence, to rigid quiet. Who cares if from now on you are linked together in evil, trapped all three in the same snare of vice, the same bond of evil flesh, companions, yes, companions for all eternity.
Wow. So what would you, how would you describe what that segment's about?
I would say that Ben and Grace have these really long conversations to kind of figure out the ultimate analysis of the problem that is Grace's mother. And so this text here is saying, you know, all of that is fueled by this hatred and this desire. And that hatred is equal of a sin as the sin which you condemn in your mother. And in fact, not just that, it's not just equal, it is absolutely united in the same, and has this strange implication that through that hatred and in the heart, it completely bonds you for all eternity. It doesn't
like bonding with Ben.
No,
or the hate bond, the hatred is, yes, bound with Grace.
She feels that her hate definitively separates her and her mother. If she can hate her mother, she'll always be different. She'll always be separate. But In fact, it's actually the opposite way. As long as you have this hatred in your heart, you will always be connected to her. And not just, yes, in the good ways. It's through the bad. It's all of this stuff. Like you have this problem with your mother, this sin, this hatred in your heart is the same. It is identical to the things that you feel she's done to you. And again, these things are like implications for the rest of your life and into eternity, for all eternity. There's nothing you can do about it after a certain point when this is all that you know. And I like this line the most, mere empty gestures, like talking about who cares of your quarrels? Who cares of all of these fucking fights between you and your mom? Mere empty gestures, meaningless cries, spent breath. You know, it really doesn't matter in the end. God doesn't give a fuck. God doesn't see any difference. Y'all are tied together.
Right. Well, yeah, I agree. Let's watch the next clip.
Yeah.
Oh, but I don't buy it, because I know let's say I got married to a guy now, I think it'd be wishful thinking. I think that would be the best way to phrase it. And lying would be the worst way to phrase it.
Okay, but you also have
wishful thinking. If I looked at, I'm going to support you in sickness and in health. Wishful thinking. I don't think I'm capable of that right now.
Okay, but is that lying? Wishful thinking? If wishful thinking is lying, okay, I was lying.
Yeah, what do you mean? Wishful thinking is lying. You're not supposed to make a commitment based on wishful thinking. And just hope it works out.
Well, I mean, I understand that, but like, I just made the best decision I could at the time. I really did wait a while before I made the decision. And I thought about it and I tried to like get it right. And I didn't
get
it right.
I think you knew you were off, but you just did it. And I think it's okay. It's understandable, but I think you should be honest. I think you knew you were off.
I didn't know.
You knew.
Of course,
you
had my doubts. I had my doubts. I did. But I didn't know whether that was like a true or not
true. I think you knew you couldn't do it, and that my life has been the result of you trying to cover up the fact that you couldn't do it for 20 years.
Okay, so,
and I think that's understandable, but you shouldn't have lied.
Okay, I guess I need to think about that, like whether or not I lied, and maybe
how does
I did.
It make any sense? You had just gotten off of like being addicted to pot. You were like a loser teaching at a Catholic high school for boys. You didn't know what you were doing with your life. You had massive family trauma that you knew you hadn't dealt with. I think you just wanted to hook dad.
Okay, but then I don't.
And I think I understand that, but I think that's what you wanted to do. You did not take the marriage seriously.
Okay, but I got pregnant. He asked me to marry him.
Grace, do you think Ortho Bro will be able to satiate your sex drive? Oh my god. Probably not, Paul. Probably not.
I realize we looked at some of this, or part of this in the last stream, but I think it matters contextually.
Or Kevin just can't, he can't get sex off the brain tonight. When we're married, Paul. Yeah, when we're married. Anyways, sorry, I guess you don't find that funny. Whatever, I guess you're...
Oh, sorry. Yes, it's funny. I'm just like, I'm thinking about like what...
No, you're angry. You're not thinking.
Okay. I'm angry. I'm angry because I don't see it that way.
I'm laughing and you're just letting me flail. Okay, you're...
Oh, if you missed the last stream, basically we were saying in some ways Grace mimics Ben here, saying like, oh, if you won't laugh with me, you know, like similar to like, oh, am I not funny? Like, aside from being in a way to attack, it seems like it's just another expression of rage at Courtney, though.
Fucking cunt. Go ahead.
All right. Well, I have something to say about the point you brought up. Which
Go
is,
ahead.
Okay, which is that I got pregnant. He asked me to marry him. I said yes, and I'm super, like, that was a terrible thing way to answer it. It's such a joke. Okay. So then I said, like, he said, like, well, maybe, like, that's not really a yes. And I was like, yeah, that's not really a yes. So then I waited, like, until you were born, you know, like, it was, like, 9 months. Like, in my mind, it was, like, I don't want to do this just to, like, because I was pregnant and afraid. I wanted to say, like, no, like, I just need to know that this is really something that, like, I want to do. I don't want to do this for those reasons. And I also knew that I was kind of, like, resistant to, like, commitment. So it's just like, okay, I had to try to sort through all of those things.
I don't know why it's important to kind of force your mom to, be humiliated like this on stream.
Mm-hmm.
I don't get it.
And try to come up with the best answer at the time. I waited. I didn't.
Yeah,
like...
but you said you got pregnant. What does that mean? You got pregnant?
I manipulated your father into having sex with me, and I wasn't careful. And yes, I did that.
Well, that's different than saying I got pregnant.
Yep, that's different. So I'm just lying. It's just lies. I understand. I can try to tell the truth. I will tell the
you
truth.
You got yourself pregnant.
We covered true? This. Do you want to skip around a little bit?
Yeah, let's skip to the sure. end.
And letting that you
up, I trapping okay. him with a baby.
Okay, so we talked about this in our last stream. We don't want to make people rewatch it because I assume most people were in here. But no matter what, we're seeing a stream where Grace is trying to humiliate her mother. This was a stream about like talking about abortion politics. It was a very normal stream that developed into literally telling Courtney that she trapped Ben. In the last stream we were in, Ben showed up and said that Courtney essentially, first he said she she raped him. And then he said, no, she didn't rape me. But he even said that they'd hooked up multiple times before this. Not, I guess they had done some heavy petting. And I don't know. he basically tries to say that he has no, he had no responsibility
control.
Like he always does. Or control.
Neither control. I often came inside for me. Mm, for sure. And he like, it's almost weird because like, didn't he say he wanted to be like a priest or something? And like,
he was thinking about it.
She got, well, either way, she got in the way of whatever he wanted to do in terms of being a Christian man. And but I think that's weird because it's like, that's your values that you set aside. Didn't you sacrifice them? Like, didn't you set those aside? Like, when you decided to, why blame someone else? Like, no priest would do that and blame women for, like...
The idea that Ben, that Courtney seduced and groomed Ben or something. Instead, no, these are two adults that made a decision to have sex. And they were in their, I think they were in their 30s when Grace was, born.
Mm-hmm.
They knew what they were doing. And instead, this was Grace yelling at her mom saying that she trapped Ben. And again, to me, it's just more abuse enacted towards Courtney. That's what it is. It's abuse enacted towards Courtney because of whatever dynamics were going in on the house, whether it was being mad at Courtney because she felt something weird was going on with Ben and Grace, which Ben even himself has said to me, you know, he won't, of course, admit to the extreme stuff, but he'll say, yes, Grace and I did have a emotionally incestuous-ish type relationship, and yeah, that must have been confusing for Courtney. But instead, Courtney gets attacked, and I just don't think that makes any sense. Okay, so we're gonna begin with. So now we're gonna kind of switch gears talk about what cases of incest that are real. Again, we're not saying we know for a fact that anything went on with Ben and Grace. It's all.
This is a this next part is basically talking about. It's basically in indirect comments to Grace saying that incest, whatever, is like cool or hot or whatever.
Right. Grace has said that incest is hot and cool and that people look at incest porn all the time. And that,
but I just wanted to showcase the reality of how irrevocably wrecked, like, it incest wrecks the families, lives, futures, future freedom, anything like that. So
yeah. All right.
Came up with a game. Mom and Dad, they would always argue and split up, and Dad was always, you know, messing around with the babysitters. And he came up with a game for me to, because Mom was always working. So he came up with a game for me to clean the room. And so I would help him clean the room. And when it came time to make the bed, and he would tell me that I was his daddy's little girl and that he loved me. Like I said, as I grew up, I found out that he had been messing with my brother and sister as well. My mom left my dad for a little bit, and her boyfriend molested me.
So this is a much longer clip, but I think we know what's being said here. She's talking about incest. She then talks about how she had relations with her own son. I think what we understand how dark something like this goes. I don't know if you'd agree with that, Amelia, but what I'd really like to do is show what Grace says in relation to talking about how hot incest is.
Mm-hmm.
So here we go. So honestly, I don't want to make everyone have to watch the entire part of the video, but it's a very, very depressing, dark, many minutes of a woman talking about being abused by her father, having an incestuous relationship after she was an adult, and then abusing her own son. And that's the reality of incest.
The reality is a cycle which you can't easily escape. It takes a lot of intervening, I mean, she talks about how much she regrets people not just being more direct with her or something like that. And she talks about how it's preventable, but the truth is that it's really difficult to say, like, is this preventable?
And so,
it's a cycle. It's passed down from family members to family members. And it's like a disease. That's basically what it, you know.
Yeah. And so for us, we're not saying we know anything has happened between Ben and Grace. That's alleged. The only thing he'll admit to is having a unhealthy, incestuous emotional relationship. That's what they've said. So here's what Grace has to say about incest.
What I'm doing is good, sort of.
Sorry, I wanted to get to the
See, thank you so much.
What I'm doing is good, sort of.
Sorry.
You know, talking about all this family problems and also creating interesting content online is what I feel called to.
Do you think is all this stuff right now, by the way, with like, are you pissed at Lala for making this clip go viral on Ethan's Twitter?
No, I think it's a hilarious clip. It works for both. What the point is that all of these abuse allegations are just people seething, because it honestly, even if you say it's all true, the problem is that it totally works for both me and my dad.
Okay. All right. All right. We're leftist faggots. Like, me and my wife were leftist faggots. So I guess, and like, you'd assume
We're both consenting adults, right? If this is all true, we'd both be consenting adults. I got all the money, right? I manipulated my dad into giving me all of his money. I do have all of it. I've manipulated him into ditching my mom, paying all the attention to me, taking care of me, giving me my own place, giving me a career, right? Like, if it's all true, how would I be the loser? Or how would he be the loser? Isn't it my mom who has no money and is taking care of my siblings who would be screwed over?
So I realize this is all theoretical. Also, this juice guy, incestuous emotional relationship, what does that mean? Well, that's, go to Grace's channel and look at the interviews that I had with Ben, and even the one from yesterday. Ben says they had some kind of strange relationship that society wouldn't approve of. That's what he said, and that it is weird, but that's just kind of how it goes. He's used many different words for it. But didn't we just have earlier in the thing, they said they've had a emotionally incestuous relationship. It's just, there's no other word for it. That's basically what they've said.
If that was all true.
Okay, so then, okay. Well, and I remember once you said in like a VC, you're like, why is everyone so obsessed with incest? Like, is it because the father is supposed to be like trusting, like, you know, is it going against a daughter to like do that with her? That's maybe what some people's issue with incest is. That like it's...
I think the reason people are so wound up about incest is because they find it hot and they don't know what to do about it. I honestly, like, if you look at Pornhub, it's like a lot of it is incest. Sure, they say stepbro, stepsis, stepmom, stepdad, but like obviously the real thing would be hotter. They're just putting that there. I mean, I think people are sexually stimulated by the concept of this, which I think is kind of gross, but I think everybody else finds it, or a lot of people find it like hot, and so then they feel like they have to have moral outrage.
Okay. So it's just interesting to me that Grace says that it's hot, but then she thinks it's gross. She throws that in there.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't understand. Everyone's wound up by incest. It's really hot to everybody, but I don't like it. Again, it feels like a Ben Thorp obfuscation.
Mm-hmm.
Say it all out there with your chest and then walk it back. It's a joke. What Ben said to Lalo, that was a joke. That was a what if, you know?
Mm-hmm.
When Ben, people use the word make out, but Ben kissed Grace on the lips yesterday at her birthday.
He immediately walked it back and said, "Hey, do you get what that was? That was that joke, me referencing the fact that that guy tried to kiss you."
Yeah, the tryptamine guy tried to kiss you.
She didn't get the joke until after he kissed her.
Right. So I just think it's interesting that she's deeply talking about this. I don't think incest is hot. I don't know. We could talk about like the like what porn is and why certain things are hot and that maybe blah blah blah. Why people think they're hot is the better term than that I do. Mm-hmm. But I
but
just
how does that like it's the question is like how does that differ? The seeking right, pornography differ from actively seeking sexual exchanges from your family members, you know, incest, like right. real incest.
Right.
I think most people do not idealize incest or see it as something
yes.
that is interesting to be involved with, no right. matter how unique that would make you. First of all, incest is not unique. And people do not pursue to have any interest in like the reality of incest. Unless they have some sort of sexual deviancy or personality disorder right. or a mental illness, you know?
Yeah. And I think, do you know the origin of the term trolling? It's phishing. So the idea is that Ben and Grace don't want anyone to think that they're in an incestuous relationship physically. But by the way to deal with that is by making everyone think they are. How does that make any sense for them? Grace says that she's embarrassed by her relationship with her father.
But what about her dad? I don't think he's embarrassed. I think he's proud. I think that he loves that this stuff is being talked about.
But we're going to get into it. But why would Grace, if she didn't want us to think that there was something going on, constantly bring it up and troll us about it? Why wouldn't she just say, fuck that, incest is disgusting. I don't have anything to do with it. We're not bringing it up. If anyone brings it up, they're banned. But yet it's constantly brought up over and over again.
Mm-hmm.
So the next
did that.
Oh, sorry, wrong one. Let's see. The next
it's the Laura Flamboyle happiness clip.
I don't know if we need it. Do you want to post it?
No.
I don't think
we get it. I just want to say this. All I want to say is nobody in their right mind aspires to be someone who is involved in incest.
Right.
It doesn't make a difference if it's legal in your state or if mm-hmm. you have the freedom and opportunity, because it's not
right.
like people don't have the same freedom or opportunity. I think that's the really weird part here is everybody has like the freedom to do these things and take the opportunity to have sex or have any kind of sexual exchange with their family members. I don't think it makes you smarter than the rest of the dads who don't choose to gratify themselves sexually with the body of their own child, for which they have allegedly. Unlimited access to day and night.
Allegedly.
Yeah. But I'm talking about people in general. It does not make you smarter that you would, like, it's not an enviable thing. That's what I'm trying to say. If somebody does this, it doesn't make you smarter than anyone else. You're doing something that anyone right. can do. So.
Right. Okay. I personally kind of want to skip the baby Playboy stuff.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. And then I'd rather go into the
other sure, Liz. Well, yeah, that's fine.
Totally. I mean, you could also.
I'll answer your question about when things have been the best.
We're repeating right now, this clip, but it's good.
Let's okay, in one of my earliest opinions for all art pro RDers, I asked about when things were best for Grace in her life, and Ben answered.
They're the best.
Okay.
I've really, kind of discovered Grace's younger sister Maggie as just this wonderful.
Oops.
Wonderful young woman. She's just so funny. And finally, one of my kids has my same spirit of like thinking things are funny and, you know, doesn't freak out about everything. I was yelling at her and she was just like,
but
so
Ben,
she's terrific.
So now you're saying
like, it's like daddy's girl. This one over here is just this. Mirror of her mother. This just never stops.
Okay,
like,
so Ben, you okay?
Grace,
I'm ready
yeah,
to dump true. Her. She's
Grace
hit the wall. Really I'm ready for
Ben,
something new.
Ben,
sucks.
Okay.
Six
I got
years.
A new daddy, anyways.
She hit the
he
wall.
Lives in Mexico, so.
Okay.
We can skip that okay. for now, but I do want to read this part. That's
yeah. No, you read it.
Okay. So in my opinion, I think Ben constantly says these truthful things out of pocket in this careless or reckless way. And this is especially when he's sort of flying off the handle as we see him in this clip. Mm-hmm. I think one of his tactics is to say things in a way that no one can tell if he's trolling or telling the truth. Even when he says, "I'm telling the sincere truth." Right after that, we see him say, "What's wrong with that?" It's another way to troll with ambiguity. So I think when we see this clip, I think what Ben says here genuinely hurts Grace's feelings. Mm-hmm. But then again,
that she hit the wall and stuff like that.
Yeah, how could it not? How could these things not hurt your feelings? But I think Ben has sort of groomed Grace to respond to these types of things by laughing and giggling at what he says. And this is a way to relieve the tension.
Right.
Of that he ambiguity.
Says, right. He says this horrific thing about her sister. She learns to laugh. We skipped the clip, but he talks about how he wishes there was baby Playboy magazine as a joke. But even Grace is like, I think, kind of thinks it's extreme, but she laughs.
He kind of messes with her by being like, "I can tell you're uncomfortable right now, Grace." And she's like, "I'm not uncomfortable. It's funny." Yeah, it's funny. I think that Ben says all of these things. They're off the handle. They're messy. They make a mess. And then Grace is there to clean up after him with a smile. She kind of giggles in this forced or false way at things.
Right.
And then that clip is... That clip right there, we watched it like three times in the last couple days. I would say, like, you know, like we've said before, it's certainly offensive to Ben when nobody laughs at his jokes.
Right.
So maybe that's why we see them be so weird about it, you know?
What's this other one? This final one? Have we seen this before?
Yeah. No, we should play it.
Okay.
No, because
she feels helpless and like a victim.
This is the thing. The thing is, my dad...
Well, Lala, why don't you continue to mock at me? Laugh at me, because I'm still being like allowing her to, you know, sort of like wreck. I'm now allowing my daughter to sort of like keep me from being able to lead a healthy, structured life, because she's saying, "Well, this thing with mom is confusing to me," right? Mm. Keep laughing, right? I really enjoy being with Grace. And we have a lot of things in common. We have very similar goals. We have very similar tastes. That doesn't always happen with the father and daughter. But I think it's a wonderful gift to us. And I think she would say the same on her side. And yet, this shit makes it very hard for us to just pursue what should be like a kit life of like, how much better would it be?
What does kit life mean? I guess,
dude, I don't.
For you, wouldn't it be so much better? Wait.
Can the chat help us?
For you, if you had like a sister
back up a little bit.
Was doing this with you?
Sorry.
Oh yeah. Wait.
He says something here that I just wanted to point out. It's kind of hard.
Was doing this
it's
with you? Who had the same
him.
Tastes?
He just said, "Why don't you? Wouldn't it be wonderful if you had a sister who was with you, who had the same tastes and things, and helped each other out?" You can play it again, but...
And then some people might say that he's referring to the house for wayward hoes, and some people might really say he's referring to Grace's actual sister moving in, but he's never...
Each other out in doing what you're doing? Wouldn't it be wonderful to have someone who's doing it with you? Who you could trust?
So he's saying he wants to move in another girl or woman or whatever you want to say into the house.
I mean, he used the word sister. I don't think he accidentally did that. I think he wasn't meaning this kind of... If he was, it's a double meaning for Grace only, to be like, it's a sort of threat. Look at her face. She feels threatened by this kind of idea. Like, wouldn't it be great if you had a sister who was here? Even if it's like a friend, it doesn't matter. It's like, it's still right. something that it's he's using to threaten her in a way.
Right.
Said, and he also says something like, wouldn't it be great if you had someone who you could trust? So that's something right. that I pointed out here. I said, Grace's little sister trusts Grace. You know, that's true. Grace trusts mm-hmm. her sister for sure, even more than mm-hmm. anyone she might meet off of the internet. And if her sister was there, she wouldn't be alone. And I know she misses her sister. And even though all of this is like, it's something that he's using to be like, wouldn't it be great if your sister was here too? This is an awful possibility. This is like,
right, but that's what everyone's afraid of. And I know that Ben would say you guys are idiots or disgusting, but he's the way he mentions the stuff about the sister as a joke. Who else jokes about that stuff? Give me another father who jokes about that stuff, about his daughter hitting the wall and the younger daughter being more interesting. I don't think any father who wasn't completely mad and insane or whatever you want to call him,
sick.
Joke about that.
Sick, no, he's yes. sick. He's sick for sure.
He can try to say it was a joke, or it's all stupid and it's all a joke, and we should get because we're idiots. We should get that it's a joke. But I just don't know anybody else that makes those kind of jokes about their own kids. And then you have this other clip with saying about sisters moving in. I just think it's too scary, and I think there's a reason to be freaked out by it. Of course,
mm-hmm.
you know?
Yeah. No matter who it is, if it's sister or internet friend, it's all
right,
scary.
Well, let's talk about this. We talk about the House for Wayward Hoes, right? Mm-hmm. And Ben had this idea for the House of Wayward Hoes. Shamu did a great video on it. We're using clips from his video where he wanted to get women in. It was supposed to be a joke, guys, right? It was a joke, right? So then Ava comes down or goes up to Rhode Island to play this bit, to do this joke. But instead, Ben immediately pulls her hair and starts acting like a real dominant daddy. This doesn't seem like a joke. Let's look at what Ben has to say about the day that Ava showed up.
Knock four times if you're alive. Oh, you took Ava down there?
Well, yeah, because she told me to come in her room, and I was like, well, I think it'd be better if me and my dad just got a little bit of space.
Good. You're gone.
So...
good. Fuck you.
All right.
What?
Well, she said that, like, you know, that I was, like, putting too much pressure on myself and that I was, like, overwhelmed.
You're a victim.
And it's, yeah. I need to work that out.
Good.
That's what you said. That you agree with her.
No, I don't.
So, Grace, tell us about.
That's what you
So even Grace was like, oh, me and my dad should have some space. He's freaking out. I think even Grace was embarrassed. I think Ava has said that. She was kind of embarrassed of the way her dad was acting, and it wasn't until later that she completely defended.
She said yesterday,
I think
it's
you're
fine
a fucking loser.
To be in the place that I'm in.
Did Ben just call Grace a fucking loser?
Yeah, definitely.
It's fine for me to be in the place that I'm in. What I'm doing
fine.
Is getting stuck.
I have nothing to say to you. Fuck. Both of you, fuck off. I don't give a shit what you're doing or why you're doing it. Just, I don't, it makes no sense to me. What the fuck? Why didn't you back me when I was trying to, like,
Grace,
hey, like, this is what this is.
Why didn't you back me, Grace, when mm-hmm. I was trying to say this is how we're going to treat Ava and this is what we're going to do to her? That Grace needs to be part of this, and she needs to be the Ghislaine Maxwell, as he calls her.
Yes.
By the way, who wants to be Ghislaine Maxwell? What the fuck?
Yeah, I really, again, it's about pride. These roles are, in society, they're not anything to be proud of. We are disgusted by Ghislaine Maxwell. Everybody hates her. But, you know, she boastfully refers to herself as Ghislaine Maxwell, as something, you know, that's been promoted in her to believe is a great, awesome thing.
Right. And that's what scares us, that it wouldn't just be Grace. She's an adult.
No,
incest is legal in Rhode Island. She can do what she wants.
No, it's
like, mm-hmm. sorry.
No, sorry, I was interrupting you.
He wants more people involved. He's kind of given up on it now, but in during this couple months ago, he was all about the House for Wayward Hoes and getting more people involved.
Well, every time.
Does Ben seem like he's joking, you guys? Is this all a big bit? Does he seem like he's trolling us?
I asked you like to do something.
Why is he
like,
so oh angry? God, right? Why it's are like they arguing? Why is oh Grace God, and him having these arguments? You know,
it's like, too why?
No. That's not true. When you asked us to say like that you live on a yacht or that you were going to take us on a yacht, I was like, yeah, that'd be funny. Didn't?
Oh, remember Ben asked for the girls to pretend like to tell the cashier that he was taking them on a yacht, like that those are his girlfriends. Mm-hmm. Another weird thing.
Right? I was like, okay. I was like planning
well,
what
you
to
went
say
away. Why didn't you say like, come on, no, let's do it.
I
take her you, side. Yes, you do.
You said you wanted her in the front seat with you. I said,
oh,
I offered
Jesus
him to be in the back
Christ.
Seat.
That's not what I'm talking about, Grace.
But I was
I'm not
I
literally
was,
talking about where you are in the car.
But I was laughing back there, but the windows were down. I was trying to participate. I kept saying
whatever,
things.
Fuck you. Then Grace's job, right, was to be the Ghislaine Maxwell to my Jeffrey Epstein.
Okay.
Oh, there you go. There you go. Yeah.
I do fear that by implicating Grace in these crimes against her involving other women, Ben puts Grace's future at this great risk. And I feel like it's on purpose to prevent her future freedom, if anything.
Yeah. Okay. So what's the next clip? Is that the doxing? Wait, no. That's Grace.
This is Grace's, sorry, reaction later, where she's trying to convince Ben that
she's
trying to do the Ghislaine thing by bringing Ava back, by shaming Ava for what she's done. And she's angry for being scolded. I think, like, you know, she's channeling her anger towards Ava for like,
I mean, let's make fucking content, right? I mean, you people paid $200 for this bitch to come out here, and what do we get? We get her secretly calling daddy saying, I feel uncomfortable, because what? My dad tugged on her hair, and...
So you're beating these hoes when they don't get in line, these dogs. This is a doghouse.
I have verbal commands. Mm-hmm. I offer a lot of incentives. I mean, what the fuck did they think it is?
Am I right? Exactly. My dad had been talking about the House for Wayward Hoes for a long time. He's not kidding about this. She is a wayward hoe. Now, does he see her as somebody that he wants to have a relationship with? No. Ava is 22 years old. She's whatever. She's a kid in his eyes. It's not like he was.
She's our first wayward hoe.
Right. So this is us, him talking about what we kind of already explained to you. I think we don't need to go through all of it, but I really think that we understand that.
Obviously.
Let me just say this. We understand that Ava was, this wasn't a bit, this wasn't a gag. Ben wanted to, I don't know, have Ava reading Bible verses on her knees. And what's funny is I would get on VCs with Grace and be like, or multiple people did this. If you guys want a submissive woman to get on the ground with their knees, on their knees and read the Bible to Ben, find some woman on some kink website or whatever. That's not even that hard. Of course, they don't want that. Okay, so Grace doxes her mom's workplace.
The place my mom works at. let me see here. This is like a local Rhode Island.
We're not saying where it
yeah,
is.
It's like just very typical like American fare, I guess. Yeah.
This was only a couple weeks ago Grace decided to dox for Courtney Woods.
Yeah, this is the so weird. It's so weird because she worked in a restaurant. You know what I mean? Collision course with the cosmic flesh sends in $5. Thank you. Why are you doxing your mom's work? Because I just think it's funny. Hmm. It's like this weird inside Rhode Island joke. It's like, I don't know what that would be like for somebody in a different state, but it's like working. My dad is demanding that I dox his texts.
So Ben tells her to dox his texts. Ben even says, Collision Course is Artie's wife. Amelia asked that. Don't smoke on camera. I want you to make meatloaf tomorrow. They say the N-word a lot to each other. Okay. Use your tits. Dox my texts. Tell them everything. Grace. Sorry, that's just funny that he uses Grace the way he screams Grace.
Mm-hmm. Keep saying it. Okay, there we go. So I brought this up because I noticed this. I thought it was pretty unusual and cruel the other day when I saw this and how much Grace was sort of giggling while doxing her mom's workplace again. And so I made that comment.
Yeah, and then Ben, we seen the text, is telling her to look up. We censored it for fun. Look it up. This is how it works. So how often when Ben's not on camera is he telling Grace what to do? I mean, look at the Smith situation. Mm-hmm. I mean, obviously he was in the chat fucking Smith.
Right.
And he's always behind the scenes telling Grace what to say or how to say it, including torturing Courtney Moore. Right? This kind of reinforcing what we've been saying.
Wait, yes. And I
that John.
Sorry.
I think that, you know, like I was like, oh, you know, Grace is just doing this on her own. She's just doxing her mom by herself. And then we see the DMs between her and Ben, and it's Ben telling her to do that. But I think, like, you know, most people might not even care about that part, and they might just like be like, oh, Grace is just this cruel person acting on her own, until we really see her being told to do these things. And I often wonder, you know, like lots of people kind of like are like, oh, this Grace is just really cruel and she like loves being that way in this merciless way. But I really wonder, like, would Grace have done that if Ben hadn't told her to do that? And
yeah, no, I don't think she would have.
And again, yeah, like,
I don't think she would have at all.
And I think, like, you know, that's the thing, is like, I feel like anybody watching would be like, you're a cruel person. And that's like a part of her reputation that, like,
that Grace is cruel. I mean, there's lots of
people. It pushes people away. Yeah.
There's lots of people, if you ask them, certain people online, that think that Grace is cruel without Ben and that she'll always be cruel. And right. I don't necessarily believe that. I think that Grace without Ben could be a very different person. I don't think she's really had the chance to be her own person, so I don't think we can judge it. But at least right now, Ben's influence is so large upon Grace, and there's so much evidence of it. And here is another example. Here's another example. Whenever I was talking to Grace on the Ava stream, I said, you cried when I asked you about your brother, Ben, John. And there was a text that was leaked that showed that Ben said to Grace to not cry, that she looked awful for crying. And this is her reaction to that.
Another thing I've always wanted to ask you. Once we were on a stream and I talked about John and you cried, everyone said you were fake crying. And then also it showed like it's you posted a bunch of texts from your dad. You don't. I can understand maybe you don't want to respond to this, but your dad was really pissed in those texts that you were crying about your brother. Do you think that's like healthy behavior?
I think that, for instance, with my brother John, I think there is an unhealthy part. Like, I think in a family, there can be an unhealthy sort of sentimentality. Like, if I was actually with my brother John, I would find it incredibly tense and sort of, like, I don't like him as a person. I think he has some good aspects, but, like, he's you know, he's absolutely, like, attempted to ruin my reputation online.
Hey, pause.
Okay.
Yeah. Right there, we just see that little bit of her saying it's John's fault for ruining her reputation online.
Right, talking about the stuff with Darius.
Yes, but in my opinion, I, you know, like Grace is obviously affected by that. She's affected by her online reputation because of the incest allegations. But I think she doesn't realize that it's like, it's not just John. It's Ben who's brought this up in the first place. And then it's her who continually brings up the subject.
Right. And then I feel like separately, I feel like if you felt that this, you talked to your father and he said, you know, yes, there was this oral rape that Grace does to me. And he's, in John's opinion, Ben did say this to him. To him, he's trying to protect his family and protect his sister. And that's just the truth. That's how he feels. That's what I mean.
No, it's fine. I mean,
so we've already seen this clip of, we saw this earlier of John telling the story of finding the texts between Grace and Ben, which Ben and Grace admitted to that. Ben admitted to that in the last stream on Grace's that I talked to him. And he said that they were sending texts that were sexual in nature, but that they were jokes. Okay. And then this clip, let's watch this one.
I'm just going to tell you because you're a person and I think it's disgusting, but she does stuff with my dad, and I know that she does stuff with my dad because they've had conversations with me where he's said that she orally rapes him.
Okay, so
actually,
then,
this is just a part of it. Sorry.
Yeah, oh,
keep
Grace,
going. Keep going. Grace just for one more time.
Bro, how do you orally rape somebody, dog? Yo, I'm a rapist right now. Oh my god, bro, call the cops. Call the cops. Yeah, I raped him.
He says that she acts crazy and she has to take it out on him by giving him blowjobs.
Okay, so then what I did, Grace often blames her brother John for the reputation. We just talked about this, but I was gonna say then I talked to Ben about this. I wanted to know. Is this true? Did this conversation take place? Was John lying about that? Let's find that out. Was John lying about that conversation where Ben told him that stuff? And keep in mind, I had actually asked Ben this in a VC that was not recorded. He originally told me, yes, he told John those things, but it was to like trick Courtney or something. Ben tells a different story here.
But that wouldn't affect my relationship with my daughter, would not affect a marriage vow in any way. I mean, I guess you could cheat on your wife with your daughter, but I mean, that's right. Not really. That's not really.
Okay.
Doesn't really make much. Like, you've got deeper problems than a marriage vow.
Okay. And okay, here's a question. You don't have to answer it. One time in a VC, you told me that because there's all the stuff about John and, you know, him saying the oral rape stuff. And you told me that you did say it, but you just didn't mean it.
Did right? Say what?
That the oral rape thing happened. But you just didn't mean it, that you lied to John. Is that what it was?
I did. I had a conversation with him. It wasn't at all what he says it was. I do think Grace does attack me quite a bit.
Okay.
And with her mouth in the sense like she's, you know, complains, cries, right. All that stuff. So and I have said also there was sort of intimacy that, you know, is like in under normal circumstances would be inappropriate. I mean, I don't think it's like normal that a father lives with his adult daughter. I don't think that's normal.
So you told
do I think
him
that that's like incest? Like you could say it's in some ways takes on those dimensions.
Right.
Okay. So in some ways, Ben said, number one, he says he did have a conversation with John. It just wasn't like that exactly. But then he did say that it does take on incestuous dimensions. He says that to us. So basically he's saying, yeah, Ben, John's not a liar. He didn't make it up. He just says, I guess what he would say is he didn't say those exact terms. But then he's basically saying that he said everything but to John.
But he does say, and Grace does attack me with her mouth. He sort of does say like, well, yeah, there's justification in what he said, and these are the kinds of things that he did say. He kind of does confirm that along the lines of what he said. Attacks me with her mouth, whatever that is. And
why would you say that?
Why would you
say that if it was a joke?
Why would you choose these words out of all the words that he chose? He could have said, Grace yells at me. Grace takes out all of this aggression and yells at me or whatever.
And instead he orally assaults me.
I think whatever he said, it doesn't matter what he said, because what matters is the fact that he impressed that idea. He impressed an idea onto John by saying or selecting whatever words he chose to say. They were ambiguous enough to impress something more physically sexual than verbally abusive, if that makes sense. It doesn't really matter what he said. It's about the fact that he did impress this idea onto John, that was happening. Why would you,
if you wanted to sit your son down, who saw these sexual texts, which the interview I had with Ben there in Grace's channel, you can look at it. He admits that there were sexual texts sent between them, but he says they were jokes. So your son, John, reads the sexual joke texts, goes to the dad to talk about them, and he just says, yeah, there's a weird relationship that takes on elements of incest. How is that supposed to make the 17-year-old feel like, oh, this is just a big misunderstanding? Why? That doesn't make any sense. Why make it worse? Is it because Ben's an idiot? I don't think Ben's an idiot.
No, I don't think so either.
There's a lot to say, but I don't think he's an idiot.
No, I've called him reckless with what he said, but he's not reckless or stupid. He's lazy and methodical or something at the same time. Like, he lets all of these obfuscations work for him in this way. Right. And I think this is just my opinion, but I think that by telling John, by selecting the language that he selected to say that, to describe what was going on between him and Grace to John, he intentionally impressed that idea upon him. And I think he made it ambiguous enough that he could back it up and say, I didn't mean that. It was a joke. But he said it in this way. He said it in this way so that John would... it would push John to imagine something. And so they could be like, you're a pervert. You've just fabricated this all in your head by taking something the wrong way. And you took it too far. But I think it's this weird loophole. It's a weird loophole of his own selection of language that he can then back up on. But really, he does it, I think, intentionally to be like, what's the big deal? At first, like, his initial response is like boastfulness, bragging.
Yeah, it is. Okay, so this next clip is another element of when we say Grace says she doesn't want to talk about the incest stuff, but then she brings up like serial killers, the serial killer Leonard Lake, and also Joseph Fritzl, a man known for incest.
Hostage. And he kept them, like, correct me if I'm wrong, RG, but he kept them in his, what do you call it? It was like the shipping containers, right? Something like that?
He created, like, this underground little dungeon that he built on his land.
Like inside of the lambs?
Well, not quite. So he had a list of rules for the women that he kept.
Oh damn! It's already brought up.
For the women that he had captive. So here are the rules. Here are the rules. Okay, let's go over them really quick. Okay, so here are the rules. Right. I think you might be like this, Darian.
Why would he be allowed to talk in bed?
He killed all these women, by the way.
RD, stop spoiling it. Okay, number three. I must never. These are legit rules. These are no. Guys, these are legit rules that Leonard Lake came up with for these women that he held captive, okay? Number three, I must never show my disrespect, either verbally or silent. I must never cross my arms or legs in front of my body or clench my fists.
He's talking about how great these rules are by the serial killer team. And all the women were killed. I don't think Ben told Grace and Courtney this, but apparently, from what I've heard, he'd bring up this case all the time. I think he just liked the rules that he set for the women. So he's saying, I read about serial killers all the time, but I don't think they're cool. I don't think the rules that they had were cool and should be talked about.
I feel like he's almost envying these crimes. Right. Like, he's like, oh my God, what a badass. Like, that would be such a cool thing to do. is like if you had these women that you could control like this in your dungeon or whatever.
Idiot. I've been interested in this stuff since I was like a kid. My dad. Dad? No.
I mean, me and my dad watched a lot of stuff on
Devil's Sorry, Children. I'm trying to.
I must understand that. No, let's go through would this. Do better if they were locked in a.
Sorry, sweet. Left.
I get that she's like playing okay. it up. And that
is but if women were given the option, okay, either you live normally like a modern woman, or you're locked in a basement, not necessarily with your father, but let's just say with an older man. You're locked like, in a basement with him, and you have to bear his kids for like 15 years. There's no sunlight or anything, but all he does is come down there and have sex with you, and you get to be with your kids all day long.
Yeah, they lived in a tiny box. Oh, I keep going. Yeah.
She's talking about Joseph Fritzl, who had sex with his daughter and had kids with her and locked her in a secret room for 15 years.
Great.
I think a lot of women might unironically do better in that situation than they do in modern life.
Okay, Grace. Okay, this is what's interesting to me. Wait, here we go.
Would you consider that with me? Would you consider doing that with me, Grace?
Grace. Okay. Aside from Spicoli saying, this is what I think is interesting about your content. We're all trying to kind of ignore all the shit with your dad. Like, Grace should have a good time in LA, but you're kind of bringing it up, right? You're like kind of messing with people, bringing it up. And it doesn't shock me or anything like that. But what I'm saying is like this. When all the John shit happened, you looked really hurt. Like you were saying, my brother's cucking me, right? Remember you said
that? Yeah,
I agree.
Stealing my boyfriend.
Which was a good joke, by the way.
I think Ben did rehearse this with Grace. I think that it was part of like some gag, but I guess the point that I try to make here is why do you keep bringing up incest even as a joke if you're trying to like get away from that and it's ruining your life and that all you want is to get away from the incest rumors.
But like you looked fucking hurt. Like this person who I hung out with, who I'm giving a bed to and feeding is going in a car alone to hear what you know.
I switch it up and I talk about, yeah, why you cried and were upset about
shit for my brother. And you have every right to feel hurt by that. But at the same time, when we all try to kind of ignore it, it peaks in. You know what I mean? Even if it's like a joke. Does that make sense?
Well, I'm not going to lie. I mean, my brother going to my neighbor back here, Jacinda, who we all know, and telling her that I am engaged in disgusting things with my father without even telling me, he just personally went,
yeah.
It does hurt me, you know, because he's my brother. And we used to be like... We used to be good friends, and him going and telling these lies to people so that she's been like thinking about this for I don't know how many months. And like, he's like a year younger than me, and it does hurt me. It does honestly hurt me.
Mm-hmm. I didn't want Grace to be upset here. I was actually shocked that Grace, you know, but hey guys, I'm such slime because I asked a question. Anyway. And she had this response. To me, it feels like she's making this joke that Ben told her to make, and then there's a real reaction.
Well, I think the connection that you made was really intuitive going from one thing to this, because the incest stuff, anytime it gets brought up, like you're saying, does affect Grace. It hurts Grace's reputation or her self-esteem, whatever you want to say. It's hurting her by bringing it up. So you're just asking, like, and then I think that connection that you made, like, with John, like, is intuitive because she does blame John for this reputation, even though it is her and her dad who keep bringing it on themselves.
Well, I mean, and I'll be the devil's advocate and say, like, you know, I don't know. I can understand why she would be embarrassed about that stuff, but I guess maybe part of what John is feeling is that he's trying to protect his family from this horrific thing her father did.
Yeah, I'm not saying that.
I know, but if we believe the timeline,
mm-hmm.
if this is all this alleged stuff happened, 2018, mm-hmm. Grace would have been 15 to 16, I believe. So in the state of Rhode Island, 15 is illegal. So we don't know for sure, but no matter what, I don't know. It's so complicated in that I don't know how, you know, I can understand her being upset that maybe he tells Jacinda or something, but at the same time, I think he was also trying to do what he felt was right into letting people know how awful Ben was, you know?
Yeah.
John would do that to me, and I just don't understand because I go on other streams and I tell people that he's a good guy, and I've always had respect for him as an artist and stuff, and I just don't really understand why he wants to hurt me. Like, I just don't really understand why it has to be so crazy, you know? Like, I'm not a bad person. I don't try to attack him.
No, you're not.
I try to promote him on every stream I'm on. I say that he's a good person. I say that he's a good artist. Like, we used to be best friends when we were kids. And now it's just like very, very distant. And I still I can't even.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm not even angry at him, you
Grace,
know?
Grace, I don't know you. I watch your streams and I'm worried about you. And I'm not talking about your dad shit. I'm not talking about dad shit. I'm talking about this right here. The pain and trauma you're dealing with.
Dude, Artie, you gotta go back the VOD like 10 minutes ago and you were like, dude, it's so crazy that people mentioned this, or you need to stop mentioning this stuff, and you like mentioned it again.
No, she mentioned it, dude. You weren't there. She was talking about Joseph Fritzl.
Okay. So anyway, she cries, she's upset.
I just think my mom.
And I think I don't know. It's one of those things where she's just completely torn down the middle. I don't know what else you would want to say.
Mm. Well, she's crying, about John saying that stuff and it affecting her reputation and her self-esteem. And that she's defined by this stuff.
Right.
And so this is one of those examples of seeing Grace. I mean, the way that happened was a very quick turn of emotion. Like,
right. And which to me,
go ahead.
Laughing, making these jokes, and then this really serious shit. We know that Grace is dealing with a lot internally. She's dealing with a lot of trauma. Even if she stays with Ben for the rest of her life, she's dealing with all this stuff that she's not really allowed to express fully. Or if she is allowed to express it, it's in this like controlled thing that Ben does with her, like the rope stream or whatever. So guys, this is 3 hours. We're almost done. We have one chapter, but it's much shorter than chapter two. Thanks for the, 18 to 20 something people that have been with us. This is our second ever stream. This is a long one. We know it's kind of weird. But we appreciate everyone hanging in there. Wait, do you have any more reading?
This is the last part. So this is especially for Grace, this chapter. I'm going to start at I ought never to have received there.
Okay. And what's the context here?
Okay, so this is it's the priest's feelings about how he interacted with Chantal, who is this girl in great distress. And so he's kind of
Who has a similar relationship with her father that Grace might have.
Yeah, right. And she's expressing rage, all of this stuff. But underneath that, he can see this despair within her. Mm-hmm. And so he's in this part of the book, the priest is being actually pretty hard on himself for how he has interacted with this girl who is in deep need of help. So,
okay. All right. And also, let me just say for anyone that was late, we're reading this book, Diary of a Country Priest, because Ben has read it. It's a book that we both love dearly. And it's a book about Catholicism and a priest's thoughts about the issues that people in this village have. So keep going. Sorry.
No problem. I ought never to have received Mademoiselle Chantal the day before yesterday. Her first visit to the presbytery was hardly conventional, and at least I ought to have interrupted her sooner. But as usual, I followed my impulse. I refused to see anything else but the girl before me, tottering as though on the brink of a double gulf of hate and despair. Oh, agonized face! Such a face can never have lied, such anguish. Yet other agonies have not managed to rouse such pity in me. Why should this pain have seemed such an intolerable challenge? My memories of unhappy childhood are still too vivid, I feel. I too experienced once this terrified shrinking from all the sorrows and shame of life. God, such revelations of impurity would prove the most ordinary of tests, if only they did not show us ourselves. That hideous voice, never yet heard, wakes in us its long murmuring echo. And what then? I ought simply to have acted with all the more prudence and discretion. Yet instead I hid out right and left at the risk, while I struck the ravening beast of wounding its defenseless, innocent prey. No priest worthy of the name sees only the concrete instance. So this section sort of will allow us to answer the question about why we're interested in making this video in the first place.
Right.
In the diary, Chantal is this troubled girl in a sort of similar situation as Grace. She hates her mother viscerally, and this is majorly because she and her father have this sort of inappropriate relationship. There is major complexity when it comes to intervening in someone's life. What makes someone qualified is the question. How does one know how to intervene without unintentionally doing harm? I ask myself this question, are we fit to make this? Who are we to make this? And this is my address to Grace. We, like the priests on page 155, are willing to admit that we are not perfect by any means, and that we do not believe that what we will say to you right now is the right thing for you at this time. But it is a risk that we are willing to take. We ought to have never made this or involve ourselves, but we are following our impulse and taking a risk. We refuse to see anything but the girl before us, teetering as though on the brink of a double gulf of hate and despair. We refuse to ignore what we see, and the look on your face when you are confused at your very brink of sanity, or exhausted and resigned to all of it. It is such a face as the one that the priest saw in Chantal after she confesses her hatred towards her mother. A face of anguish. The priest says, other agonies have not managed to rouse such pity in me. And it's true that I too have seen many things, many agonized faces. But the way that you looked when your dad told you that you hit a wall, you are worthless, you are unintelligent, you are a problem. When he roused you to say that you want to kill your mother, every instance I saw, that made me feel incredible distress for you, not for me. Why should this pity I feel for you be so intolerable for me that I might make a video about it? To quote the priest, my memories of unhappy childhood are still too vivid, I feel. I experienced once this terrifying shrinking from all the sorrow and shame of life. So this is true for me as well, and for my husband too. The trauma and agonies that we've experienced in our own lives, these dark memories or past experiences of fear and wanting to run away from what's happened, this is what has influenced us or informed us and our reasoning behind taking this risk. And it is a risk. However, it's not the kind of risk that we're afraid of because of what might happen to us, but what might happen to you. I want to point out what he said. Such revelations of impurity would prove the most ordinary of tests if only they did not show us ourselves. Impurity, of course, here means a sickness of the intellect, one that spreads more sickness with actions and words. So when we see this stuff, it would not rouse such pity if we did not truly in some way relate to you. In a limited way, of course. We do not see what happens when the cameras go off and you are living your everyday life. I can't possibly understand the complexity of your life, your circumstances, your relationships. But I recognize the anguish on your face. The expressions I've seen give me a tiny partial view into what it's like, how life is treating you. It's a sort of echo in that it's so familiar, almost universal. A face that's not your own, but of some prey being attacked by some hostile beast. And again, we're speaking of a metaphorical beast that is the sickness and not a human culprit or attacker. So I'll keep going to explain why it's a risk. He says, and what then? The priest is being hypercritical about his way of handling and interacting with Chantal, who's in distress. He is saying, yes, I know I feel great distress for her, but the way I should have handled her confession should have been with more prudence and discretion. Yet instead, I hit out right and left at the risk while I struck the ravening beast of wounding its defenseless innocent prey. You are so ensnared in the clutches of the ravening beast, like a large snake encircling your entire body. Anyone who recognizes your distress and attempts to do something about it by taking a jab at the beast risks wounding you, its defenseless prey. As hard as this may be to hear, people watch you in this agony because you are in such a terrifying position. They can do nothing for you but to continue to inflict more pain upon you as they watch, throwing stones at you and the beast, adding to the agony of the struggle you are already in. And I'm sorry if this comes at you like another stone, but I pray that if it does not hit the beast, that this stone hits somewhere in you that jostles you out of your coma of resignation and wakes you up so you can start fighting back again.
Well, yeah. Thanks for writing that, Amelia. I didn't read it until you decided to read it. So I guess this last kind of clip, I feel like, is a great example. It's from the end of Shambu's documentary as to why we, I don't know, it's referencing what you're talking about with the face. Here. From the end. Sorry, guys. This is after court.
Hey guys.
Hey Grace,
how you doing?
No. Oh my God. I was having a hard time, and you were
not even OBS. You were
calling me. Am I
mean to you?
No, you said you were
mean
to me.
You never mean to me. I didn't mean it. I didn't mean it.
I am a dumb bitch, so you're right.
No, you're not. You're young, and you have a lot of mistakes to make until you figure out who you are in person.
You want to see my outfit? Okay, ready? I'm wearing my dad's jacket. It's a really nice jacket.
He
has like a little patch, and it has, oh, it's like Nike. And it says, oh.
I'm wearing Nike too, dude.
It says,
Air
Jordan.
Oishla
on the back.
Air Walsh.
Are you crying, Grace?
Yeah.
She's been crying.
Why? What happened?
I don't know.
Why are you crying?
I have my little kitty ball. Oh, Grace. That's my outfit. You guys like it?
Yeah, it's
You guys like it? I feel so sad right now.
Don't feel the same.
I like it, but the fact that you're crying makes it weird.
But it's like good crying. It's good crying, right? Anyways, David is ignoring me. I like cool boys. I'm gonna let you talk.
So how are you doing, Grace? What's up? Why are you so fat?
I don't know. I feel like my siblings. Are David's kids yelling in the background?
Yes.
Yeah. Your kids are very weird.
Yeah, I know. Dude, I have like eight kids. There's never gonna be a time where they're not yelling. So I just have to live with that.
Hey, at least you responded to me.
Against the fucking wall. Shut the fuck up.
I feel so sad. My fucking sibling, my 16-year-old brother is here.
and he yelled at me for leaving him in his mom's house. Oh, I'm sorry, I couldn't take Negro and my mom, and I had to leave, and you have to sit there with her and get pizza with her. I'm so sorry for you. Girl bitching at me. Fuck off!
Dude,
yeah.
You're mad about the pizza
that
you're not eating. That's the main
thing. Are you crying because you didn't get pizza? What's up with the problem?
Grace,
can I stop dropping
for you? Nobody cares, dude. All you have is my
dude. I talking that much, but.
Yeah. Oh, shit. Big Ben. Big Ben's in the house.
Oh, Big Ben. Big Ben, are you going to sit down and have fucking seat? Grace, are you
probably going to military, Ben? You look like G.I. Joe, but fat.
G.I. Gay.
Come on, Ben. Speak. Nice V-neck t-shirt, you homosexual.
I bought that jacket.
Why don't you get a Ralph Lauren polo, like a real...
No,
I can put some polo. Let me listen. Fuck off, dude. Fuck you, Grace. Yeah, you can dance, bitch. It's annoying me. Fuck out of my face.
How come you don't like me
anymore? I never liked you.
Yeah, you did.
Get the bathroom.
No, I didn't. Nobody likes you.
All right. I think, I don't know. I know that's the end of Shamu's documentary, but those dogs need that. But I feel like that, seeing that clip affected me. That was part of what got me interested into this whole thing.
Me too.
And thanks everyone for sitting through this, for letting people read weird old French books to you.
Yeah, thank you for letting me bore you to death on Halloween.
I don't know. I just hope for the best for Courtney and Grace and John and all the kids. And I hope that Ben can find some peace in his life as well.
Yeah.
I don't know what that justice or peace entails. Bye, everyone. Say bye to Una. She's mad. Bye, guys. Have a good one.
Bye.